Hey, it's the Bennington Show live on a Monday. Starting to show off with little Michael Penn, easily my third favorite Penn brother. So, top three, pick up the bronze, big man. I love you.
But that's pretty good odds.
But it's unbelievable. that song is great. I'm sure, Gail, you picked it because of the video, Paul Thomas Anderson video, which he kind of repeated that with Radiohead.
Yeah, he has a thing for the tracking shots.
Right.
And he has a thing for musicians walking down hallways and through doors.
Let's face it, Radiohead ripped off Michael Penn once again.
When are they not ripping off Michael Penn?
Thank you. Because they're also married to Amy Mann right now, which is terrible.
Lucky.
Yeah, of course lucky. Yeah, but the Penn brothers are always great. I know some people get mad, but I never do.
Don't be mad at the Penns.
No. All right, it is a Monday. It was the big Mother's Day weekend. We finally got a little sun here on the East Coast, and we kind of have jumped from late winter into early summer, bypassing spring completely.
I'm ready for it. I will not complain. After that week of
I'm going to remember you saying that.
I won't. I dare you to catch me saying,
I'm going
it's too hot.
Pull this,
the
Joe.
The sun's so shiny.
Yes, Joe. No one ever says the sun shows so shiny.
I hate that giant shiny sun.
What?
What?
Shiny.
That was you jumping in today, and that's what you yelled? That giant shiny sun? Pull that, would you?
Pull that as well.
Just put it with all the others that we don't understand.
And if I ever complain, play that right after so I'm no longer embarrassed. Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, but Chris said this, don't forget.
Yeah, that's easy. And it is always good to have a Chris around. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
that's like when someone
easier.
Said the dog farted. because everyone's like, probably farts a lot. I don't mind. All right, it is Monday, and we were going to talk about Trump, but how can you? Because there's so much stuff happening, you really can't keep up with them. It's just too much, too fast. I'm a little more shocked by this story. Ozzy and Sharon, it's over.
What?
Yeah, they're done with each other. Sharon cannot put up with it.
That is shocking to me. You would never suspect. They seem like they have a very serious understanding. Like they rely on each other a lot.
That's the way it used to be when it was back in when they had their own show. But no, I think Sharon has her own life. Ozzy's left alone. He has a hairdresser. He's going to bang her. You know what I mean? I mean, I'm sorry if you're going to be out there. I think her show is called The Chew that she does every day. No, which she's...
The Talk?
She's just on The Talk. And they bring up things and they talk it out. And why that's happening, Ozzy's left alone. And it's more than he can bear.
Yeah, I mean, who would have thought her and the daughter have sort of surpassed him in stardom?
Do you think that they're bigger than Ozzy Osbourne?
I think that at this point, they are more of a household name than he is.
Yeah, I don't think that's passing him. You know what I mean? Like,
right.
Charles Manson is more of a household name than, let's say, Coldplay. I would even say, if you said to people, who's Coldplay and who's Charlie Manson, at least in America, you're going to get more Charlie Manson.
Because he's infamous.
Yeah, he is infamous. And I think that's where Sharon is. Like, she's always good for this, that, but he's the guy with the catalog. He pretty much invented heavy metal.
But it seems like he doesn't even seem like he's brought up a lot by them. You know, I remember, like, he was kind of the core, the centerpiece
right.
of it, and it was like, what it's like being in Ozzy's family.
Well, you think someone's going to say to Ozzy's daughter, what do you think Ozzy would think of that dress? the good news is here, he's back on Eddie Trunk's show. Monday, I'm sure. I'm sure that quickly, the day after the divorce, because this might not stick. You know what I mean?
Well, at least some good comes out of it then.
What, being on Eddie Trunk's
yeah.
show? Sure. And maybe, you know, he'll start touring again and stuff.
Maybe it's best for both of them.
I know it's best for both of them. I think it's best for America.
She'll be able to talk. He'll be able to rock.
Yeah.
It's perfect.
You know what? It seems like it was almost a slow news weekend in a lot of ways. Well, you know, I guess everybody was with their moms. The Dwayne Wade taking shots during the Canadian national anthem. This was a, this was a complete fuck up. You cannot keep shooting during someone's national anthem.
It's almost as if he just didn't recognize it. Like, he's just like, he was unaware that something very official was happening.
But this happens every time you go to Toronto. The other part of it, too, is somebody was enabling. Somebody was sitting there. Look, that little girl is just going for it, too. She doesn't give a shit.
Yeah, someone was feeding him while he was...
But you gotta have people... You know, it used to be assistant coaches would walk around, like, on a football field telling people to spit their gum out. You know what I mean? You didn't want to be caught chewing gum.
He's going to have to do a lap for that.
You certainly... I mean, if Canada was a little more of a tenser country, we'd really have some fucking heat here. But this is just flat out, you know, but it's wrong.
Just because they're laid back doesn't mean that gives us the right to disrespect them, you know?
I agree. 100%. This sucks. Dwayne Wade should be, I think, thrown out of North America for this.
You
and also for not for being past his prime.
Oh, God, yeah.
They know how much we love and respect Canada.
We love them. That's our best buddies. And they got a better song than us. I don't have any problem saying that.
Much more singable.
Why don't we just try to bring both countries under the same song would be a better idea.
Let's just use theirs and just say, "Oh, North America," instead of "Oh, Canada."
I got one for you.
Okay.
Song about America by a Canadian band, American Woman, which everybody loves.
Yeah. Either you're a woman or you love women.
Yes.
Or you're a friend of a woman.
Yeah.
And it's for everyone.
The opening riff is amazing. Oh, see, he doesn't go from that. He goes from the album cut. Just leave it. It's going to be right there. We know when it kicks in. We're not going to do this part as the anthem.
No, we'll skip over this part.
Oh, no music. American woman, we're not there yet, folks.
Mess your mind. American woman, just keep waiting.
Now, just imagine you're just sitting in either country, but solidly in the same continent. And it's time for the national anthem. You're not even paying attention right now. You're talking with your friends.
Just enjoying.
You're passing around popcorn and hot dogs. You're doing key bumps. Whatever.
Yeah, American
you're gonna do
stuff.
Before the, for the game. American woman, gonna mess your mind. Put the whole intro in there. Here we go, the start of the song. You're gonna be up.
Please arise!
North America, this is your anthem!
Is fun.
Yeah.
No.
I definitely would.
American woman, stay away
from me. Place will be going crazy. Woman, mama, let me be. And then you have two countries completely happy with themselves.
Can you imagine if you were if we were playing a non-North American country, you hear this? The team's coming out to this.
Fuck, you're gonna look over, Brazil's gonna be dancing. This blows that ole ole shit away. That other country is trying to steal, which annoys me. Now you've got a tune that both countries can get behind. The United States, Canada, North America. Or can we jump in with a little LCD sound system.
North American Scum?
Yeah. We slowly go for that now. Boy, we never need a Vito more than we do today.
I miss him.
Oh, God, he was great. He was always on it.
He was so good. And he never had ads before his videos.
No ads. He was always just ready to jump up and get into it.
It's very intimidating.
I know. Who still think we're from England. But it's also when you just call yourself Scum from the get, you know what I mean? It's like a motorcycle gang. Like, yeah, we know we're Scum. We're going to fuck you up now. Either way, and especially I think with American Woman, every time that you play it at a sporting event, some guy's got to be on a Harley with a bigger North American flag. Maybe we put together a North American flag, too. Instead of the stars, we just have maple leaves.
Little
there.
Maple leaves?
Yeah, it's a place for everybody. Nick and Alberta.
Hey, Ron, how's it going?
Cool, man.
Yeah, I'm kind of pissed off that Chris Stanley there fucked up the intro to our national anthem. I'm from Canada, and I'm pissed.
I know. I understand. The thing is, it's just the early days of the new continental anthem that we're trying to do.
We're working out the kinks.
And if we do something with the Kinks, that would be amazing.
Oh, okay.
But if, you know. Start
an international incident, but, you know, don't forget we always have 20,000 nukes pointed at you guys, so.
You know what? Yeah. Do me a favor and just launch them.
Dude, now might be the
time. I can't put up with it anymore. Launch away. And we apologize for Dwayne Wade, and you should have launched then. We realize that we need a national anthem. People bitching the app is fucked up. Please pass that along, will you, Chris? And maybe what we could do is have one of my many producers, if you guys want to be here, is follow Twitter and see if the audience is happy or if they have problems on a daily basis. Here's Murray in Toronto.
Hey,
buddy.
Ronnie, how are you?
Cool.
Good. Listen, a little commentary on two things. First of all, Dwayne Wade, the actual Canadian national anthem is Taking Care of Business by BTO.
I have all no right? problem with that one at all.
Yeah. And he was probably waiting for that one. And really, come on, we don't care. We might have a chance at the playoffs, the Raptors. Okay.
You know better than that. You know better than that.
No, if we make it past Miami and hit Cleveland, we're dead. So,
you got Drake. You know what I mean?
Yeah. At least that.
Yeah, exactly. Except if you're old, fat, and 50, and you can't dance to Drake. But here's another thing.
No, just dance slow. It's not difficult. Drake can't even dance to Drake.
Yeah, that's the great thing about it.
Yeah.
Listen, best Canadian, if we join together and we have one national anthem,
yeah.
I would like to vote, and think about this, Ronnie, Paradise by the Dashboard Light.
It's too wedding songy to me. You know what I mean? I want to make... Here's what I think between us and Canada. What's the main thing that we're drifting to? A pro-marijuana continent.
Okay, yeah, definitely.
I was talking to a friend of mine yesterday. He says he gets out of the fucking train in Union Square, and they were selling weed out of a truck. Just a truck set up, and they were just selling little fucking packages. Anybody walking by could pick up a party package for themselves. Canada's big into weed now. America's slowly becoming big into weed. Let's have a song that people want to wake and then bake. A song that you can't not love. This is another song. You just sing along with the riff.
This will bring our countries together.
Right. And enough of this Trump wall thing. We had Mexico in. Now Mexico is part of it. And anytime we play the national anthem, you have a Mexican kid driving out with a fucking lowrider. The flag is on it.
The North American flag.
And it just starts that bounce thing.
Yeah.
What is that
hydraulics.
Even called?
Yeah, hydraulics.
Yeah, but doesn't it have a name?
I don't know.
Not sure.
That never caught on outside of Mexicans.
No
white kid wanted his car to bounce.
Never really outside the West Coast.
The only person
Miami has some of it.
Do they?
A little bit, yeah.
The only person white guy I ever saw bouncing was our own Vito. When he gets in
there. Oh, yeah. The build?
Yeah. He goes out of the build.
Wait for that drop.
Shane Shane in Ohio. We're pulling a continent together this morning. What do you got for us?
Yeah, hey, Ronnie. I'm going to go with Captain America calling back here.
The Kinks. That's the Kinks song.
There you go.
I forgot this song, tell you the truth. This was like 1970s Kinks. This is when, you know, we had the gas crisis or whatever, and inflation, and the Kinks thought that America should get down on their knees and start begging. You're keeping an eye on the songs, and you're one up ahead of it, right, Chris?
Mm-hmm.
So what's the line are you giving me?
You go to five.
Hey, here is David Rochester.
Buddies, every time this subject comes up, I call with the same song. Someday these governments are going to listen.
Yeah.
Kick Out the Jams is the national anthem.
Well, you know, Kick Out the Jams not only would be a great national anthem, but the first song ever played on GPS.
Yes.
Which, you know, was our way of saying, you know, kick out the jams, motherfucker.
We're about to kick out the jams.
Now, couldn't you see President Bernie Sanders walking out to that? $27. Everybody gives $27. 27, of course, is the age that kills so many rock stars. 27 is our number that we do. You give $27. I will never mention the fact that Hillary could be indicted. What a fucking terrible campaign that dude ran. All you had to do was say that day one. Aren't you afraid she's going to be indicted? You'd be running against Trump right now.
Don't forget that whole possible indicted thing.
You know, the FBI is looking into her.
Trump blamed her over the weekend for her husband banging chicks. She enabled him. It was terrible the way she abused. They were abused. It was like one of those moms teaching babysitters how to fuck videos that is put on Pornhub. Here's Jason, Thousand Islands. Jason, right in between two powerful nations, should know how to bring us all together. What do you got, Jason?
Here. Yeah, we're at WBTF LTFM 88.5. Ronnie, hey, how about Living in America, James Brown?
You know, James Brown, Living in America. You know, he was past his prime, but you got to admit, when you were watching Rock, you got into this a little bit.
It's pretty damn good.
Yeah. Not going to give me signals. I'll give me a... Tim in Florida. Tim.
Yo, how about something from Grand Funk Railroad? We're coming to your town. We'll help you party it down. We're an American band.
You know, these fine ladies, they had a plan. They was out to meet the boys in the band. They said, come on, dudes. Cowbell, too. Start this shit with some cowbell. I tell you, I don't think we're ever going to go wrong with a little fucking power trio.
Mm-mm. And I think that the cowbell could be our official instrument of North America.
Isn't it already? Is there a song out there that works that maybe a movie is using or a TV show? I definitely would love to hear Go by Dave Hill, which... You know, pumps up every Sunday night.
It's political now.
It's political already. And Dave Hill coming in here a little later on.
Yes.
To talk about his book. Dave Hill doesn't live here anymore. And there he is with his beautiful hair. He's holding a little Cleveland house. And, you know, Cleveland is, you know, to me, the heart of rock and roll.
Cleveland rocks.
Yeah.
Bringing joy to the end.
I know.
Joyful.
Wait a minute. If you're saying joyful, what about that new song of the summer JTT just laid on everybody, the ripoff of Happy?
Yeah, why not?
That is, I mean, for someone to be so cynical to go, look, these fuckers want to get happy. Let's give them joy.
Oh, you want to be happy, do you?
Is that it? Is that the kind of shit you're buying now? Because I'll give it to you. I think the Song of the Summer is already locked down because he's got already all the B sitcom stars dancing around. So, all right, let's take a listen to that, Chris. Throughout our history. Oh, boy, you're struggling with it today, huh? You need Vito back?
You miss them?
Is that when you're at your best? Come on, it's okay. Everybody should admit when they need a hand.
Here we go.
He's not even talking to me. He's just ignoring.
This is just you.
Oh, God. Song of the summer, though?
I'm sure it's going to be. It has all the elements.
Somebody better jump up.
And they let that JTT get away with anything.
Murder! Murder this fucker gets away with. All right. Josh, SC.
Hey, what's up, buddies?
Hey.
David Bowie, you could go one of two ways with the current political situation. You should go, this is not America, or, of course, Young Americans.
Well, you know what? We could do Young Americans, which you're going to jump off
okay,
then.
This is great.
If this works when, you know, we're at peacetime, but then I'm afraid of Americans when we're at war. And then that way people will know.
Yeah, they'll see the duality of yeah. this place.
And they'll also, they'll hear the national anthem and they'll know where we are. Are we in peace and war? Like, let's suppose just on a, like, let's suppose that, like, just after 9/11, you were starting to hear this. As soon as the shit started to go down, the news anchors just fucking hit a button.
A national anthem yeah. produced by Trent Reznor? What could
Love
be better?
It. When I first heard the terrible news that Bowie died, I immediately said, was it Trent Reznor? That was my first fucking thought, that Reznor caught him.
Because it did seem like he was following him, didn't it?
Oh, he was stalking that poor man for years. Here's Sean. Sean in Seattle.
Hey, what's up, Ron?
Hey.
So I originally called with Freedom from Rage Against the Machine.
Yeah.
But as I was sitting on hold, I was thinking maybe American Badass by Rock Kid Rock.
Yeah, that's not going to happen.
We're not going to get everyone to agree on that. I'm sorry.
All right, let's try American Badass, though. Because The Undertaker used it for a while, right?
Yeah, that was his thing.
He's pretty popular in North America,
pretty?
Right?
Pretty? Oh, my God. The hell's in the cells alone.
This was his that biker.
Yeah, he went through an odd biker period, like a lot of people do.
No Rogaine in the propane.
What?
Spam message. I'm not sure. We're going to get everyone.
Well, let's at least get to the hook. I mean, I have no problem with cutting the rap out of it. No. I changed my mind. I can't even make it to the hook. Let's go, Chuck. Chuck in Missouri.
Hi, Ronnie. How y'all doing today? How about going a little old school? Go with Neil Diamond, America.
Well, that would work for tax. There's no doubt about that.
Well, we got our borders opened up, so hell, let everybody come in.
Yeah, I agree there. I want to do just the opposite of a wall and maybe put a water slide.
Oh.
Because imagine what a good mood it is if you're going to water slide into a country.
That
water
would
parks
be great.
Are the shit.
Oh, they're the best. Tubes or belly down.
Oh, yeah.
And that'll help, you know, illegal substances coming in. You're like, hey, you got to leave this here. Unless you want to get it wet.
That's true.
There's only one way into this country.
Yeah, water slide.
You're going to water slide today.
I wouldn't mind water sliding in every fucking country. A little later on today, Dave Hill is going to be here. So you can still hear GPS Manchester on replay. And this coming Friday at 2 o'clock, we're playing Dana Carvey as he did his town hall. We were the first people to know that he was going to be on SNL, but we were told to take a look.
We had inside information.
Yeah, we had the inside info.
It was pretty exciting. That was so much fun. That was
well,
a really fun
Here's why it was
hall.
Fun. You could ask questions. And then I said, since, you know, Dana Carvey is one of the world's great impressionists, and he's got this new show on, TV show, about impressionists, that you could ask a question if you did an impression first. And we had Chris Stanley, Gail, Tommy Rhodes. Who else do we know that I made do impressions?
Kashmir.
Kashmir did a terrible impression.
Really bad one.
And then our old intern, Antony. Mm-hmm. And You can see, like, the town hall audience is just across the entire platform, so they're not necessarily Raw Dog people. But we were all dying, and they were looking at us like, these are all bad impressions.
These people are pretty weird.
They do not know their impressions. And that was making me happier. That was making me much happier than need be. Mark in Ohio.
Yeah, Ronnie. What about Miley Cyrus's Party in the USA?
Well, you know what? You're never going to go too wrong with that Miley Cyrus.
It's catchy.
Who's the photographer that did her?
Terry Richardson?
Yeah, Terry Richardson. Those are my favorite Miley Cyrus pictures ever. Where you're basically looking at a fucking prisoner who was given over to the system. Terry Richardson has some pictures up. I think of his wife or his baby mama.
Baby mama.
Yeah.
Yeah, put it up. It's on the iBang right now.
It's got the picture up of the twins on the twins.
Yeah. He's got the twins enjoying some mama milk. And I guess this could be considered somewhat sweet if it was from anybody but Terry Richardson.
His prison tattoo on head glasses are just really off-putting.
She even looks young, huh?
She does have a young look about her.
She's 14.
But, oh, God.
Okay, that makes sense. That's why she would look so young. But it's funny, if you go through Instagram, the comments are so complete opposite. Like, there's people like, beautiful mama, this is so natural and wonderful. And then people are like, ew, gross.
Yeah. Chris, you fall into the gross phase, or you into the beautiful phase?
It's like, I'm like, it's off-putting me, because it's like, there are bare breasts out there being sucked.
Right.
So I feel it's off-putting. I wouldn't say it's disgusting, I just feel weird about it.
You feel uncomfortable.
Uncomfortable, a lot, it's extreme uncomfortable.
That she's
it takes you a long time to find your emotion, doesn't it? It takes a lot of rambling before you got to the thing, uncomfortable. And that's because a nipple is being suckled.
Yes, exactly.
But you realize that this is the only reason for nipples.
Yeah, I mean, it's the practical reason.
Yeah. Chris is like, he's grossed out if he sees water coming out of a faucet.
Ew.
Like,
ew.
Why?
They're for sucking on and jacking. Joey Jojo, a Midwestern conservative liberal.
Yeah.
He votes liberal, acts conservative. That's the weird thing about that part of the country.
Love big oil.
Yeah. Now, this picture of the teats of Terry Richardson's, I'll just say, child bride being sucked by his child groomsman. Natural or off-putting?
For me, natural. I've never had a problem with breastfeeding.
Farm boy. You're farm a farm boy. Yeah. You call it breastfeeding.
Yeah.
See, that's the difference. He grew up around this in Minnesota.
No.
When sometimes you had to bring the cows in and let the babies suck straight and suckle off of them.
Sure.
Miss home, yeah.
Now, let's go to Vito. Vito is a conservative Italian, one of the few Republicans on the Upper West Side. Vito. Off-putting, like Chris Stanley said, or natural? Sweet.
For me, it's off-putting because the nipples are so dark and it makes me uncomfortable.
So your biggest problem is dark nipples.
It's the darkness of the nipples.
Now,
dark
nipples. I just want to point that out. The darkness that you see may be the baby's heads.
It's getting in the way. I like a nice pair of nipples, and those aren't a nice pair of nipples in my eyes.
Jesus. Because they're being used properly.
Right.
Yeah.
Oh,
you know what you'd like? Men.
Yeah.
You would love men.
Yeah, great nipples.
Get Joe to show you his nipples. He's got tiny, dime-sized nipples that are inverted. And now he's poking them.
How's the color for you? Better?
That's a good nipple.
Yeah. All right. Now, here's the deal. Normally, I'm on the side of, oh, women, blah, blah, blah. But this is Terry Richardson.
So
just putting out a shock fucking thing.
Yeah.
He's like, wait till everyone sees this. They're going to fucking explode.
Yeah, he knows. He's trolling. He's waiting.
Did you see Terry Richardson on the street once?
I did.
Oh, was you?
I did, yeah.
Yeah. What did you say to him?
I didn't say anything to him, yeah. But like I felt strangely uncomfortable by his gaze. Like there was something about his gaze that felt like I feel naked right now and I don't know why.
Yeah, he basically would have been better off in the 70s when New York City just had those giant places that you could go to that had mattresses, stained mattresses on the floor.
Sure.
You could just bang people on First Avenue.
A nice little flop house situation.
What was the Plato's Retreat, I believe was the name of it.
In the 70s, right?
Yeah, see where that one was. That was probably the biggest. And I believe, I'm not 100% sure, but I believe Gurion went there.
I think it was in the Insomnia on the Upper West Side.
This is it relocated in the 80 to West 34th Street. And before that it was on
in the 80. Do you mean the year 80?
In the year 1980.
So you just said in the 80. That's the way you'd talk to people.
In the 70s it was on 23rd between Lexington and 3rd.
In the 70s?
So maybe it was a different place. Look, he's fucking just so crushed by this, Vito. None of his New York history ever works out.
Bullshit fun facts.
But there was more than one, you know, joint like that. But I think Plato's Retreat was the biggest of them all. Now, there is a Amy Schumer book cover where she's topless. That's up on the iBank. Lord knows a day shouldn't go by that it isn't. Yeah, there it is. Her suckling two babies.
Yeah, this is the cover of her new book, right?
I haven't seen it yet. So there she is. Well, she looks fantastic.
She looks great. It's a very pretty photo. The girl with the lower back tattoo is the name of the book.
But she doesn't have a lower back tattoo.
No, I don't think she does, but I think she's making a tramp stamp.
She wants to.
She might have to get it now.
All right, Chris, what works better for you is natural.
Yeah.
The girl with the lower back tattoo or Terry Richardson's child bride suckling two young children?
It's the child bride is more sexual to me.
Oh my God. Because there's babies involved.
There's a baby. They're eating.
The children.
There's children there, right?
Yes.
How could it be sexual?
Why do you feel sexual when you see two twin babies?
You know what? He wouldn't even need the woman in the tits in it. He'd just see the two babies.
No, I need the woman.
He would jack to a fucking nursery picture.
Oh, Chris!
I would not.
You'd have.
No.
So that's the more sexual one for you.
Yes, because there's bare breasts, you know, suckling.
Oh. I think... what would you call that area with the bump on her back right there? Is that a tumor of some kind?
That's like a little
wing?
Is that her little wing bone?
Yeah, but doesn't that have a name? It can't be called wing bone.
Scapula?
Scapula? That's the thing that you cut people.
No, that's a scalpel. It's a scapula? Or that's something over
I don't
here?
Know. You're asking me like I'm your health
teacher. Everyone knows the wing bone.
It's a scapula.
Yeah.
Scapula?
Scapula. The old scapula.
Now, if you saw babies suckling on that, would that work for you?
Chris, how would you feel about that if you saw them nursing her little wings?
And Vito, if that had a nipple on it, would you be satisfied?
Depends on the color of the nipple.
Now, here's the weird thing about America. Come in for Michelle. I just wanted to tell her. Michelle, what's her friend's name? That got the half hour comedy
Nick
hour?
Nick Turner.
Yeah.
Hi,
we wanted to tell you this real quick, Michelle. Your friend Nick Turner has just announced half hour comedy
I'm
hour.
I'm so excited!
Yeah. And then our friend Mike Racine has gotten one.
That's
the corner that hasn't been turned. They've given him a half hour comedy hour.
Did I say see Ramon Rivas also was
Ramon? Yeah, from Cleveland.
Ramon.
Ramon Rivas is.
You know, Happy Mother's Day.
Oh. Happy, yeah. But I texted you yesterday, like everybody else from the show did.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, no. Chris, thanks.
Oh, no.
Thanks, Gail.
You're welcome.
Thanks, no. Joe.
You're welcome.
Joe, did you go home to see your mom?
No, but I did FaceTime her.
You're a bad son.
Oh, no.
FT is not enough.
I can't practically do that.
Did you beat off your mom?
Oh my God.
Yeah, he did.
Oh, my God.
I believe you, Michelle. I think
you crossed the line.
Did.
Michelle had a lovely Mother's Day. She let her children go into the woods unattended.
They're still there.
Yeah.
From what I can understand.
We were in Brooklyn at Gail's place yesterday, and we're walking down the street, and there was a little kid in a diaper walking around a garage by himself. And I said, I didn't know Michelle lived in Brooklyn. And then my whole family had a big laugh together. And then we saw the mom was only a couple feet away. And I was so disappointed.
Never mind. It's nothing like Michelle.
I hate my children.
She's in with eyesight of her kids.
Mine are with ISIS.
Ooh.
I got to do a voiceover.
Go. Bye. Enjoy.
Love you.
Love you too.
You should just record it here.
Yeah, we'll send it over. We'll do it with you. Next week on Best of the 80s. James in Fairfax, how are you?
I'm doing good. Wonderful show, guys. You did a great GPS this weekend. It was great hearing some of those old tunes I hadn't heard in a long time.
Yeah, it was a great scene.
You know, I was just thinking, you know, about producers. I talked to you about on Friday about Journey, and I'm wondering about, you know, Roy Thomas Baker was the first guy who took over Journey's first three albums with Steve Perry, and I'm wondering how many things from Roy Thomas Baker that you dislike. But
God, hold on. Anyways, I'm gonna put you on hold and come back to you. How do we not know who's calling the show, dude? How do we not know? How are we gonna get this team together? That's crazy, Journey guy. Which, by the way, I took the time to listen to the song.
How was it?
Sweet and simple.
Yeah, I felt like I was listening to Journey. That's all. No different.
So you loved it.
Yeah. I'm not going to get into whatever his name is, Roy Thomas Baker or whatever. But, yeah, the Manchester scene was a lot of fun.
It was so much fun.
We're going to give out the prize. And, well, let's do it at the top of the hour.
Okay, sounds good.
We'll just hand out a prize. What do we have? A signed DVD?
We have a signed DVD, Joy Division, signed by Peter Hook.
Yeah, the great Peter Hook.
And a t-shirt. It was a twofer prize.
Oh, I'm not signing it, though.
You have to.
Well, I'll sign it.
You must. I've already promised it.
Also up on the iBank today, great article and pictures of Anthony DeVito, one of our favorite people in the world.
Oh, love Anthony.
Yeah. But these things are starting to become, for me, one of the best things on the iBank. Because you're just in his neighborhood, Astoria.
Beautiful Astoria.
He brings up in there that he picked the other sandwich shop away from you, Chris.
Oh, good.
But he said he loves Astoria. He's Astoria's number one citizen.
Astoria's own.
I'm Astoria's number one citizen.
Why?
He also gives one of the most embarrassing breakup stories I ever heard in my life during this.
I love a good breakup story.
His breakup story basically was he was just crushed from it. And he was in the park there in Astoria and he saw a bird and he gave the pain to the bird. And as the bird flew away, so did his troubles. And then he told his ex that and she laughed in his stupid, fat, bearded face. She laughed at him. Dan the Man stopping in today too, right?
Yeah, yes, Dan Perlman.
The show Hindsight is happening tomorrow, May 10th at 7:30 p.m. at Caroline's Comedy Club in New York City. Go to carolines.com for tickets.
Mm, I want to see that.
Yeah, me too.
I'll probably go to it.
Yeah, me too.
Probably go to every show out there right now.
What aren't you going to go see?
All of them.
Oh.
Everything I say is, so in fact, a lie.
So confusing.
I really just going to go to Terry Richardson's house and help him suckle the babies. You know what I'm kind of proud of, though, for him? That she does have pants on. She's wearing a little pair of shorts. I didn't expect that.
Is she wearing pants?
I thought she was naked.
You don't see, like, pink or something underneath there?
I think that's the baby's feet.
Yeah, I think she's naked. I think she's pantsless.
See, that's pink baby skin.
That's that feet. Baby needs some fucking something then.
Breast milk?
No, I don't think breast milk is going to make it any less red. What are those babies, like a minute old?
Yeah, they're pretty teeny.
And by the way, giant tornadoes everywhere in the country right now. Just tearing the country apart.
Oh, scary.
I know.
Tornado.
It seems to me that tornadoes are getting more powerful. They're bigger. They're uglier. They're tighter. I was watching one on CNN today. I couldn't take my eyes off of it.
Do you find the tornado to be the scariest of the natural disaster?
Great question. No, I got to tell you, tsunami, wall of water.
That's me too. I think about that one more often, like, and I've had like dreams like that. So I think for some reason
there was right before we in Daytona, a wall of water that hit once, just one single giant wave. And some people thought, look at that, though. That's fucking scary as shit.
It's really
and storm
scary.
Chasers are fucking idiots. They should be storm runner away from. They don't fucking help us in any way.
They're just extreme is what they are.
Well, they are extreme. But look at a tornado.
Oh, my
it's
God. That's
frightening.
Insane.
Jesus. Now, imagine that. Now, they're in Oklahoma and places like, right?
Yeah.
But because of fracking, they said Oklahoma's had 825 fucking earthquakes of various sizes in 1 year.
From fracking. They think the fracking is causing...
What else is it going to be from? It's the only thing that changed. Now, here's the deal. They could easily get an earthquake the same time as a tornado now.
I just throw myself in a tornado, say, God wants us all to die. If it's happening at the same time...
I didn't know
time,
you were that religious.
I guess I'm not.
I'm thinking, and I might be wrong here, but Trump's wall may stop some of these tornadoes because they got to build up down south, you know?
Maybe he could make the wall out of tornadoes.
That doesn't make sense. Seriously, I mean, I'm all for brainstorming, but we can't go that far. Look at that fucking tornado.
Why are they getting closer and closer?
They're bigger and they're better formed than ever before. I think a lot of it has to do with CGI. Look at that fucking
holy
thing.
Holy shit.
No way.
Wow, that's a really great shot. I don't think I've ever seen detail
I know, they
like
get
that.
Better
that was
like
really
that every day.
Jesus.
That is so scary. I can't believe that.
Have you ever been anywhere and saw like a one of those things just whip across the field and it seems like it's a tornado, but it's very small?
Yeah.
Yeah. One time I was playing baseball and we saw a tornado just come across the infield. I'm sitting, our team was at bat, so we're sitting on the bench watching it, and it just whipped across the infield and went right into the shortstop where we couldn't see him anymore, and it moved up, and he was just like, and it was like, everyone just fucking sat there, and we were like, should we leave? Is this the start of a real tornado? The coach is like, no, that's just wind in a field.
Tornadoes probably what I was most obsessed with when I was a kid. As far as, like, terrified of a natural disaster. Whoa, what,
dude,
is that
what,
the road
it leave?
On?
Yeah, it tore up the fucking road like that?
Yeah.
Holy shit.
Why wouldn't those cars be backing up in case that thing turns towards them? Oh, because they're storm chasers? Yeah. Those aren't regular people?
Storm. So that's, is that the road all ripped
yeah.
up like that?
This guy's doing a bad job of fucking shooting.
Wow, that's insane.
And we're just at the start of tornado season, right?
Yeah, I think it does start, it goes through through the whole summer, right?
Through the whole summer, and then you have the series in October. So, it's just real, and hurricane season. Now, I've seen water spouts, too, in Florida.
That
and those,
I've seen.
Those are pretty spooky looking, because the water is just being sucked up. Ugh. All weather fucking blows so bad. One thing I would be, if I was Bernie Sanders, is getting rid of weather.
No more weather.
Just put a giant dome over the country. Actually, in fifth grade, I did do dome cities as a report. And I thought to myself, And I even had the thing where if it rains on the dome, we can turn that water into drinking water.
Great.
It'll all come down and we can purify
it. So you were way ahead of Under the Dome.
I felt like everybody in my class had done something on some kind of a dome. You know what I mean? Like, I don't want to feel like I was totally original because it seemed like our whole class. Like, it just seemed because back in those days, people were, you know, flying into space and shit, that all this stuff was doable. A lot of people did domes on the moon, domes on Mars. Mine was a dome over Chester, Pennsylvania. And I said, not only keeping the weather out, but keeping you-know-who in. Electrical storms get to you at all? Like when it's just a lot of lightning like that?
I think I was pretty used to them growing up in
Florida. Yeah.
Yeah. I was pretty fascinated by lightning. I wasn't too
scared. You lived in the lightning capital of, you know, the Tampa Bay area. It just gets more lightning than any place else in the country.
Yeah.
And you'll get the occasional hail there too. So for you, Chris, earthquake, tornado, what's scarier?
Earthquake. It's the earth ripping apart.
Well, it's not even so much ripping apart, but it almost looks like the ground turns liquid. It just starts
to move
like waves.
And we were up here that day when the that earthquake happened, and feeling the building roll was fucking creepy as shit.
Well, you could feel it up here.
Here's what it felt like. It felt like we were bouncing on a basketball. Like, we were just sitting on top of, like, one of those yoga balls that everybody has now. And yeah. It was just, we heard a bump, 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 bump. We just felt it. And I was like, oh, that's peculiar. I looked down the hall, and I saw that everybody in the hall had stopped and was just, like, locking in. And we were like, oh, shit.
Yeah, New York, you're not going to think earthquake.
No. We thought that somebody obviously had driven a fucking, you know, a van full of explosives into the building. But then our lines light up. All across the eastern seaboard, I felt it. We had to play that on a best of one day because it's amazing of, you know, when you're doing a national show where that many people, and it went, I believe, from like Georgia to Canada, the people that felt it in some way. D.C. got it very heavily where the Washington Monument kind of shifted and they had to do repairs on it and stuff. But, you know, we're 36 floors up in the air. You don't want to move.
Oh, yeah. I was in a dressing room of a clothing store, and the whole place started shaking, and I thought I was having a panic attack. I did not think earthquake at all. I was like, I'm fucking losing it. I sat down. I was just like, I don't know who to call right now.
That's a narcissist. Like,
then when I left the building, there were people all lined up outside, and they were like, did you just come from inside there? Yeah. That earthquake was insane. I was like, oh my God, that was an earthquake. I thought I was having a panic attack.
Pat in Florida. Hey, Pat.
Hey there, Ron. You know, being down here in Florida, you know, we got the hurricanes, tornadoes.
Yeah.
Those you can usually avoid because you know they're coming. Okay. But when you got tsunamis or earthquakes, you know, with earthquakes, you don't know when they're going to happen. And the tsunamis, I mean, you don't know how far inland you got to go.
Well, a tsunami kind of starts from an earthquake in the middle of the sea, right?
Yeah.
Who's that?
That's Brooke.
That's Brooke.
You know Brooke. That looked like Dana when she made the corner turn.
She's got a Dana look about her.
Those little tough girls have that look. yeah, tsunami. Now everyone knows if there's like a sudden low tide, don't go running out into it. You know, people didn't know that fact. You know, it wasn't something that got reported a lot. Everyone was like, hey, look how far out I can go.
Look at all these shells.
Yeah, this is great. Look, no. I found a jellyfish. Now I can't make my way back in. Earthquake. I just remember, I don't remember so many earthquakes in the middle of the country or on the East Coast. I remember one time when I was a kid, I woke up before a little earthquake. I just wake up. I'm laying in my bed. I hear this, I feel this rumbling. My mom and dad jump up, as always, thinking the heater had exploded. They just, every night, thought that the heater was going to explode for some reason.
It's happening.
Now, this is the weird thing about me. I remember hearing that ruckus and just being like, oh, shit, and going back to sleep. Just like literally, like I don't want to be around any of this.
Oh yeah, when you're a kid, you're just like adults will deal with this.
Yeah, this is something for the adults. Maybe they'll carry me out of here later. James, Oregon.
Hey, Bennington, how you doing?
Cool, man.
Hey, one thing about those earthquakes in Oklahoma, it's not so much fracking does cause earthquakes, but what they do when they separate the oil from the water, the wastewater that's left over, they re-inject that down into a layer way, way, way down, and that's what's causing all the earthquakes. We had out here one day, I was in my truck just in Tulsa, had three earthquakes in one evening. I mean, like 4 hours apart. It was crazy.
Now, and you didn't grow up with earthquakes, right?
I'm from the West Coast, so, I'm more in tune to the big stuff, but at the same time, you know, I'm not so worried about tsunamis in Oklahoma.
But you do have to start worrying about sinkholes, I guess, if there's enough of these.
Sinkholes can be a problem with when you're extracting so much, you know, material from the earth, no doubt. But they don't have a sinkhole issue like they do in Florida, not out here, no.
I've seen them in Florida just suck a house in. Suck a fucking house in. And not be found. The house wasn't fucking
found.
Wait,
they can't, like, go into the fucking sinkhole?
No, it went so fucking deep. That was it.
Fuck that!
I mean, How's that an answer when adults are talking? You can't say fuck that.
No one chose it.
Is Dan here?
Yes, Dan is here. He signed in.
Well, let's break. We'll be back with our buddy Dan Perlman. His new show, Hindsight, happening tomorrow, May 10th, at Caroline's Comedy Club in New York City, at Dan J. Perlman. A little later on today, for first responders, we're going to give out a signed book for Dave Hill, Doesn't Live Here Anymore, signed by Dave Hill. And I found this out. Gallery has a signed book by him because she went to his first book signing a couple years ago.
I did. I have a signed copy of his first book, Tasteful Nudes.
So Fangirl finally gets to sit here and be with her one-time idol. You can't do that anymore.
I know.
You can't be your idol once you're hosting a show. Oh. We'll be right back. Bennington.
It's like a 140-character live journal. It's hashtag Bennington. Tweet it.
Joe. Oh, my God. Look who's back with us.
It's Dan Perlman.
Dan Perlman.
Dan's show is happening tomorrow, May 10th, 7:30 p.m. at Caroline's Comedy Club in New York City. Go to carolines.com for tickets. And if you want to follow him on Twitter, and you should, it's at Dan J. Perlman.
Dan Perlman has, you've seen him in the news because he said he hasn't coming around to be able to endorse Donald Trump yet. You're going to meet with him in a week, and you guys are going to go over stuff?
We'll go over, we'll see how we can bring the establishment together.
Right.
Rally the base.
Some of your problems are in American cartooning. What is that all about, then? What are you concerned about?
I just think we need to make sure that no Muslim cartoon characters come in until we figure out what the hell is going on.
But here's the thing. If you take a guy like Chris, and you were born and raised in America, right?
Yes, I was.
He's more into tentacle porn than anything else. Yes.
Love it.
Yeah.
Hentai.
He's cultured.
Now, Chris, have you been to Arthur Avenue?
No, I have not.
I came back in here, right? We haven't seen Dan in how long? Months?
Yeah.
A couple months, yeah.
And him and Chris are yelling back and forth because Chris is acting like, who cares about Arthur Avenue?
Well, fucking Dan brought up the Bronx.
Yeah.
He's like, I was like...
Are you living in the Bronx now?
No, but it's a borough.
Oh, yeah. It's an outer borough.
And he's like, the Bronx is nice. Ever been to Arthur Avenue? And then I just got annoyed because everyone brings up Arthur Avenue. The Bronx is huge. It is a giant borough.
Yeah.
There's a lot more to it than
Arthur. Yeah, but you don't spend any time in the Bronx.
You don't go to the Bronx. No. You don't even go to Yankee Stadium. You're a Mets fan.
So how would you know? Maybe Arthur Avenue is the best thing to bring up.
But you've never been. That was all I asked. I said, have you ever been? And you're like, everybody fucking brings this up. Everybody brings up Arthur. Yeah, just
why
just
can't
say
you
haven't
just
been.
Sit there and just have a conversation.
Say yes or no.
Because I'm tired of hearing about Arthur Avenue every time the Bronx comes up.
You hadn't heard it from Dan.
Yeah.
But I've heard it from other people.
Yeah, you also hear good morning, good afternoon.
Here's
a lot of things come up.
You're going to go up.
Everybody brings up good
morning.
You're
going to go out to the zoo this summer?
Yeah.
It's right there. Stop.
Yeah.
At Arthur Avenue, get yourself a nice sandwich or some pasta. And then go to the zoo.
I'm going to get a sandwich from my place in the story and bring it up to the Bronx.
What is your place? God.
Sal, Chris, and Charlie's, the sandwich king.
Sal, Chris, and Charlie's.
Sal, Chris, and Charlie's. South Chris and Charlie's.
Well, Greg Stone told me the place was a hellhole.
Yeah, he said it blows.
Do not believe anything fucking Greg Stone says.
I've been with Stone to his place. It's very good.
Oh, yeah. Oh, you know, they named a sandwich after him.
That's very exciting. Yes. Yeah.
He's on his way. He is on his way.
I was with him there once, and he got a different sandwich. He didn't get his own.
I got a prediction about Greg Stone. I have a feeling that his life is going to be great.
Really?
I think he's going to fall into a couple of things because here's what the thing about Greg Stone is. Not all comedians have this. He makes the room better. He brings a little happiness to the room. You know, when he's talking about where to get the best sandwich, I'm like, I'm going to go there.
No, don't believe him.
Yeah. And not only that, it makes you want to go with him.
Oh, yeah.
You just like want to hang out with him.
I've been saying this about him for years. He's the Arthur Avenue of comics.
He is. Making sense. He is the best. That's because you don't go to the Bronx.
Everyone's bringing him up.
Bronx fans
get it.
You got to go
to the Bronx. You're not going to enough places. If anyone wants to see where Chris lives, watch the movie War of the Worlds, and that's the part that's blowing. Spielberg came in and blew up your neighborhood, right?
Yeah, he fucking wiped it the fuck out.
Yeah, really and annoying. Also, one of my favorite movies, Guide to Recognizing Your Saints, is there. And here's the thing. This is when Robert Downey Jr., when he was doing bad, mm-hmm. compared to when he's doing better in his personal life, and he just makes 60 shitty Iron Man movies in a row. I'd rather he did bad for the rest of his life.
Oh, so much
and
better.
And made good movies.
Love that movie.
Yeah.
It's great.
And that other dunce was in it, too. The Magic Mike was in it.
Yeah.
He was like a half a tard in that movie.
Yeah,
what's Mike's name? Magic Mike?
It's just Magic Mike is what everybody's calling him. He's doing a Vegas show. Joe, weren't you saying that he's bringing his talents to Vegas now?
Yeah, he's doing a show there and dancing.
As Magic Mike?
As Magic Mike. It's like a touring company.
That's great.
His wife is a dancer. She's gorgeous, too. I saw, I forget what it was. Somebody sent me her Instagram where she was dancing.
Really?
I think her name is Magic Martha. I'm not sure.
Perfect.
That whole family can dance, though.
Imagine.
Dancing is the nuttiest thing I think that humans do.
Oh, it's very weird that we...
What's weirder, that we dance at all, or some people watch people dance? Like, watch my body move around. It's
he moves
crazy.
His body perfectly.
I wish I could do that. That brings everything to life. It's
dance?
You're not a dancer?
To be sad when you're watching someone dance.
Well, I don't know if you can be sad and dance. I guess there's sad dances like ballet that people are mournful dancers, but no jitterbug has ever been in a bad mood.
Just one single cheer while you're jitterbugging?
I think jitterbug fucking was the high water mark for American dance.
Jitterbug.
Yeah. You're just twisting chicks around, chucking them in the air,
oh, yeah.
Whipping them upside down.
It's just Barnum and Bailey. It's really just a circus act.
I'll tell you this. No one ever brings it up. Fucking love Barnum, but I hated Bailey. I mean, he was a piece of garbage.
He's really that shitty?
Oh, the worst. Now, Barnum was the Arthur Avenue of circus folk.
Even
that's
back
true.
Then.
That's
yeah, a- that's when something's at its peak, Chris. You never been up there?
Never been.
You gotta go up.
It's weird that you haven't.
Not going now.
Who always wants to bring us an Arthur Avenue?
Hosp.
Hosp, the great Hosp. Who, I don't know, we didn't see it that last Doug Benson show. He had went the night before and later tweeted out his disappointment because I had played for him the last time.
Oh, yeah.
And won for him.
Won big.
Yeah, I guess
all
I did.
All the prizes.
Yeah, I guess you do get every prize that people bring in. But the prizes were so shitty this time. I'm going to go out of my way and say it. They were terrible what the guests brought in.
You had a good prize.
Thanks to Chris Stangley.
Amazing prize.
Yeah, really.
I had a free gift pass to Arthur Avenue.
Perfect.
Yeah, place went crazy.
Then you don't have an excuse not to go.
No, there is no excuse not to go.
There's plenty of excuses. Everyone talks about it. Everyone knows about it. I got to find another avenue in the Bronx.
You got to go to Arthur Avenue.
Are you going to get swim lessons this year, Chris?
Yeah, I'll get swim lessons, sure. Then, bust that shit out.
The day that it's over, we're going to send you to a water park. Your first time at a water park.
I think Action Park, or there's a new incarnation of Action Park, so I'll go there.
Yeah, but it's not as good. Did we put the Action Park up?
Yeah,
today?
That's up.
Is that up on the iBang? For people in Jersey, have you ever heard of this before? It was
no.
An 80s and 90s thing. It was supposedly the most dangerous park that ever existed for kids to go to.
Yeah, kids were getting injured on every ride. It was just
Jersey, just straight out Jersey, like what you would imagine people in Jersey doing? Because I remember in Jersey, even the water parks there were made out of cement.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Their first water parks were made out of cement.
I went to Action Park once. And A, it was the shit. It was amazing. Two, there...
A and two. Yes!
There we go.
Normally it's A1 sauce.
And the ambulance showed up because they had a ride that was just a cliff.
What year were you there?
Like 90 or something like that?
Yeah, because it was supposed to like 79 to the early 90s when Action Park was at its best.
Yeah, and the ride was you just jump off a cliff into some water, but it was shallow. So some people were fucking themselves up.
It's not a ride. It's a very loose definition of what a carnival ride is. But the Cyclone, the whole appeal of the Cyclone is that they haven't updated it for any modern safety conditions.
Oh, well, even then, even when the Cyclone first came out. See, right. This is what you got to understand about the idea of a roller coaster. The idea was a runaway train, right? Because people only took... This would be like now, I've got a ride. It's called the plane crash, where you feel like you're in a plane and it loses control and comes down out of the sky.
I love it.
So the Cyclone, they also used to call it like the teeth buster or something.
Oh, yeah.
And back then, people couldn't get a lot of decent dental work done. Like if your front teeth got knocked out, you just rode that out until you died.
I've had some really bad injuries on the Cyclone.
And don't go on that thing.
And I have been witness to other people having really bad injuries. I had a huge bruise where the person next to me like slammed into me and just the hip bone had just bruised my side. Another person was wearing open toe shoes and the top of it was like exposed sharp metal. And she cut the top of her foot really bad in the middle of the ride.
Yeah. Well, that's the way it was set up. Here's Gary in Jersey. Gary wants to talk about Action Park. What's up, Gary?
Yeah, how you guys doing?
I can't begin to tell you. I mean, I'm feeling Arthur Avenue today. I feel so good.
Anyway, I used to go up that way when we used to go to a winery up past Action Park and wait until everybody got a good buzz on and then come back. They had this thing called the Alpine Slide, which was a concrete, like a half of a pipe, like a half pipe that went from the top of the mountain all the way down. They stick out a plastic sled with wheels, and you just flew down a thing with a brake that would scrape against the concrete if you got going too fast, which did nothing but shoot up sparks. And everybody that went down that thing would always be road rash up the ass.
How do they not make a movie out of this? And this goes to show you the difference of the parents in the 70s. We're just like, go get out of here. Go spend the day at Action Park.
It would rip the skin off your body.
Yeah, and then if you came back crying to your parents, they're like, what's wrong with the baby girl?
A boo-hoo. Huh?
Need all your skin to have a fun day?
Oh, you need both arms.
Yeah. Wah. You better toughen up. The world's a hard place. Every day is an Arthur Avenue, my friend. Sometimes you're going to be getting a sandwich in Astoria, and you got to shut up and eat that pissy, soggy Astoria sandwich from Glen Clifton, Texas.
South Crisp and Charlie's, it's crisp and delicious and fresh.
Crisp?
Oh, God, who wants a crisp sandwich?
Everyone does.
So crisp.
This sandwich is so crisp.
It's refreshing.
Bum, 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 bum. Look who it is. It's a world-renowned movie reviewer and the man on the edge of Hollywood, Jermaine Lassier. G-Baby, what's up, buddy?
Hey, buddies. So you talk about Action Park. I used to go a lot when I was a kid, but you also mentioned about a movie. Last I heard, I haven't heard anything specific about it, but Johnny Knoxville was supposed to be making a movie about it.
Perfect.
And it's sort of like a Bad Grandpa where it's a story with real stunts in it.
Uh-huh.
I heard they were filming it like late last year, and I haven't heard anything since. But I think that's going to be something that happens in the next year, a year and a half. So it sounds like perfect. And yeah, I got my legs scraped up on the Alpine slide. I belly flopped on the Tarzan swing, and it was painful, but it was a lot of fun.
Was it fun, though, or was it just, like, something your older brother made you do?
No, it was fun, like, because it was, like, death-defying, but you felt like you were safe for some reason because you were an 8-year-old kid. Right. You look at it now and obviously was not safe. And that slide, that circular slide that went upside down was always looming, and it was always, like, just people would
look at it and talk about it. I tell stories of kids dying in it.
That, it's so funny. It's such a funny concept of these shitty parks.
Super dangerous.
We're looking at a picture now, this one with two tracks, and it just looks like a ditch going down the hill. That's the Alpine
side? That's it. Yeah, that's Alpine's right there.
They're like on a board with like wheels on.
Oh, my God.
And you could open it up and go really fast, but then, you know, there'd be somebody in front of you who wasn't going as fast, so you ram into them, cause a sort of chain reaction behind you. And if you went too fast and put your leg down, yeah, you're just getting scraped up. You see the bottom of that, and it was just like ripped, you know, calves all up and down.
Oh,
bloody
God.
Fucking bottom of that Alpine slide. And they had go-karts there, too, that they rigged to go faster than, like, regulation. Like, the whole thing was just a weird just fucking racket.
It's not street legal.
And they had the thing called the Tarzan swing, which they still might have at the new iteration, but it was basically, you know, you swing into a thing of water, but they didn't really figure out the physics of it, so you had to tuck your legs. And if you didn't tuck your legs, you would hit the water, and people would just faceplant over and over and over again as their legs just hit the water as they were swinging by it. And there was, like, a crowd of, like, you know, 100 people in line around them, and they would all go, oh, as you, like, faceplanted there. It was really, really funny.
That's the weird thing about it is I don't think this could have been in any place but Jersey. There's no place that would have... you have to accept the mafia before you can accept Action Park. As just something that happens.
Well, we already have the mafia, so...
Most of these kids are going to die either from the mafia or squealing on the mafia. All right, G-Baby, already out of our movie of the summer is already out, huh?
The biggest one, yeah, Civil War. But we'll see. I'm hoping there's better stuff. Like I think you guys mentioned, it's not looking like a great summer. I mean, there's really not that much exciting stuff.
Yeah,
so
I know.
Hopefully there'll be some stuff, a little diamonds in the rough. But I'll keep you guys updated.
Did you see the Jason Bateman film that he did?
With Nicole Kidman? I have not seen that yet. You know what you guys would love, though?
Yeah.
There's a movie out called Sing Street. It's by the guy who did Once, and it's about this, like...
No.
Kid in the 80s who made a band in Ireland.
I don't know. I just hate it Once so much.
I didn't see Once.
I called it Once is Enough. That was my funny review that I don't even do reviews. All right, I'll keep an eye out for it because I like Irish people, but that guy drives me nuts. And
it's all like 80s. It's all 80s pop songs. Like the kid was influenced by like Duran Duran, The Cure, and they have all these new songs on it. And you know, it's about him falling in love with a girl through his band, but it's really, really good.
Seems like this should be called Twice. talk to you later, buddy.
Later, buddy.
Peace. Dan Perlman's sitting in with us. Dan, can you give us any updates on your animated feature that...
Yeah, so we're going back and forth. We're getting notes from the studio and the network, so they give their stupid notes, and then we go back and change whatever we can change and then make it all seem like it was their idea,
right?
No matter how dumb it was. It's like, hey, we took your note on something that wasn't their note, and they're like, that's great, because that was the thing I thought. And so the script just got approved, and now probably we'll move forward with like the casting, I guess, is the next step.
Is any of the characters a kind of martial arts teacher who's been down on his luck through alcoholism? Because listen to this.
I've been drinking too long. You got cry, child.
Oh, that's good.
Give me more sake.
I like this guy.
Yeah.
He's the sage wisdom
guy. Yeah, sage, but he's also an alcoholic. Okay. Raging alcoholic.
That's perfect.
Shut up. Learn what for. Learn how kick works.
You know, just
that's good.
Yeah, I don't know whether it fits or not. That's just
it probably
me.
Will.
And I'm probably gonna do one with Joe anyway.
Yeah, there's one Australian guy who I think Joe.
Oh yeah, you call that a spoon? I'll show you a spoon.
Kind of like that.
I don't know if that was it, but
keep it here in my pouch.
You can't set Joe up. That's one of the things you got to learn in life.
Crikey.
Joe cannot be set up.
Mad Lob City.
Oh, because I've set him up a couple times and just have him do this. No, I don't know anything about that.
Rockets?
My favorite is when he'll miss his Toonies and Loonies line.
I know. The only line that he's famous for.
Yeah, he was the one who said it. That's 5,000 times.
That's his Make America Great Again. You know what is funny about him is he thought we were going to start and laugh at it.
Eventually.
Yeah. And we never did until we took it from him. And then now we laugh at it every time. Any of us steal it, we're always happy.
It's something of the border thing. Yeah. South of the border.
You written any new comedy, Joe?
Not as of late. I had blessed
came up
that
on the dream.
Joke.
Huh?
Oh, the last one I wrote was, I've been moonlighting as a werewolf, but I can only say that during Halloween. That's the last one I wrote.
So then fucking build on that.
That's good, right?
That's pretty good, yeah.
That's the beginning of a fucking beautiful premise.
I mean, is that something he could do on hindsight, or?
I don't know about hindsight, but he got robbed on tell a joke or be a joke.
Yeah,
Dude, we gotta do that again.
That would be great. I would love to.
You got the guy, you got the young guys?
Oh, yeah, I know guys who would be good for that.
All right, let's just say 100%. This, because we're so lazy. Let's say within 2 weeks of today, we're going to announce when we're doing that again.
Whoa.
Let's put ourselves. Right. Or Chris Stanley runs down Fifth Avenue naked.
We're going to be announced this thing 2 weeks.
Sparkler up his ass. Oh, God. Burning. And I'll be videoing. So either way, we're going to have something great to announce.
You know, as much as I like tell a joke or be a joke, that
like
sounds
that
pretty
lot.
Good.
I'm going to stop taking phone calls. Well, the Comedy 101, tell a joke or be a joke, was pure perfection. Pure perfection.
It was a blast.
And we all said, oh, we're going to do this again quickly. But, you know, we all get busy in our lives.
Life gets in the way.
You got a movie offer, Gail. Sure. Dan got his offer to do a big cartoon. Chris is going to Arthur Avenue and grab sandwiches and bring them back to us.
Finally.
We're all doing stuff.
Finally.
Long time coming.
Hey, who are you giving out the prize to from GPS over the weekend?
All right, I'm going to announce it right now. This is the winner for the hashtag contest, going to win a signed Bennington t-shirt and a signed Joy Division DVD signed by Peter Hook. The winner is...
Well, let's give us the line first.
Okay, I'm going to give you the line first.
Yeah.
The line is, hey, Manchester, PA's miracle baby, Ron Bennington, and his kid, Gail Ann, are going to bring you back to Manchester in the 80s. Hashtag Deep Tracks.
Hey, man.
Chester.
Chester's miracle baby. That's beautiful. I'm 100% in for that. Who's that?
The winner is Larry and Yonkers.
Larry!
I'm crying, Larry! But you can't see because I'm in the water.
Gail's doing a Jimmy Schubert callback.
From the early to mid-90s.
Dude, Flathead shared a fucking special that Schubert shot. And crushed it.
Yeah?
I mean, he basically went in and beat the room down with an axe. He throttled that room.
I want to see that.
It's great. I'm going to, I had it. I'll write back to Flats. You even got Flats' stuff, Chris?
Yeah, I have his.
You don't really stay in touch with people, I notice. Hey, did you see Mike Racine got a...
I'm very excited about that. The whole list was great. It was so many funny comics there. I was really happy to see that.
You know, it's a new generation. That's what's happening. It's a new generation. Joe Mackey.
Racine, Joe Mackey, Aparna, Drew Michael, Jackie Novak.
Ramon Rivas.
Yeah, Ramon Rivas. Nick Turner.
Nick Turner did our show before.
Yeah, a lot of super funny comics. Yeah, it's great.
You like the half hour comedy?
I mean, it's good they're doing it. I was talking to one comic about it. It's like, you know, they make such a big deal within the comedy world, but, you know, outside of that, no one really cares, you know.
It's a very weird thing. The presentation of comedy needs to be done differently somehow. I don't know yet how to do it, but it needs to be done differently. Then just like 12 o'clock at night, a half hour show runs.
Right, and maybe they show it once again ever. But then most of it then exists in just like whatever snippets online they choose to post.
But it's like you can't get an hour unless you do your half hour. Right? Am I right about that?
Yeah.
Now it's like the new stepping stone up to it. Like,
but here's the deal. Now you take your half hour that you built and you can't put that into your hour.
Right.
You're actually pushing your hour back at least by a year or two.
I remember reading. So Bill Burr did his half hour when HBO was doing theirs for a little bit, and he had that great, like pesto bit about like not wanting to go to brunch on Sundays. People like, oh, you got to put that in your hour. You got to put that, and he wanted to, but he didn't want to end up being, oh, you're the pesto guy.
Yeah,
so
right.
If you do it twice, two different specials, then you're the pesto guy.
Well, that's what. That's why Gaffigan can't walk down the street without somebody yelling Hot Pocket at him.
Right.
And you can see it, just a little cringe, like, yeah. Did a Hot Pocket thing like 8 years ago.
It was
not
a
gonna lie to you.
Hot Pocket joke. You got me.
Yeah. Hot Pockets, right? You love them?
Honey, it's Hot Pockets.
I'm glad with Dan that we're forcing ourselves that we're going to make an announcement within 2 weeks.
2 weeks.
2 weeks. I'll get the
this
names.
This is what we got to do more in life is like, put a gun in our own mouth.
Yeah.
Start to pull the trigger.
Okay.
And then try to figure a way not to have it go off.
Yeah.
And that's what we're doing with this. We need a club to do it in.
Yeah.
We need great amateur comics, and we need great judges, comedy judges.
Now, I have a question for you. Do you think that the winner should return and defend the title, or is this all new guys?
Oh, you're really making us put another gun in our mouth.
That I didn't think that was a gun.
Who's the winner again?
Phil Philly.
Yeah, he's got.
He's got some strong Holocaust denying stuff that he's been working on.
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
And he's got some edgy stuff as he builds it.
Edgier. Dan, who's involved with your cartoon so far right now? Just you.
Me and my friend Will Julian.
Mm.
Yeah.
And that's it.
Yeah.
That's all you've got from staff at this time.
Right.
Exciting.
Yeah.
That's exciting.
Really?
It's really cool.
This is the way
yeah.
Bernie Sanders got started. Look at him now.
Yeah.
Getting the silver medal from
that's
the Democrats.
Drop out. Yeah.
Everything, just $27 donations. That's it.
$27 donations.
Yeah. The average never moved in a year, apparently. It stayed rock solid.
Those people heard that and everyone just started donating exactly $27.
No one wanted to fuck up the average.
I'd go 29 or even 31.
Well, that's nice. That's really generous.
Sure. But, you know, he has stayed with that. And he's made more money. He spent more money than Trump, believe it or not.
Really?
Oh, yeah. Trump has only spent like $10 million.
Well, he kind of doesn't have to because
he
tweets
and he calls morning shows.
Yeah.
Hello, it's Donald Trump. And I just wanted to say that I also hate Muslims' beliefs, and they're out to kill us. It's a bad thing. I don't know why they're doing it. I'm going to get rid of Paul Ryan, though. He's dead to me.
He does what so many unemployed people do, just tweet and call in shows, but he just has billions of dollars and does it from a castle.
He has a castle in the sky. His castle is up in the sky. In just a few minutes, Dave Hill is stopping by, and he's put out a really, really funny book. And part of it is that he did a ringtone for Donald Trump.
Yes, I can't wait to talk to him about that because that's a very weird credit to have.
Why did we stop caring about ringtones? Why don't we like them anymore?
We stopped.
All phones now have this. Like, there's a regular Apple ring and an Android ring. And whenever anyone's cell phone goes off now, you think it's your fucking cell phone.
I mean, why can't I hear Oasis?
Yeah.
I think Apple made it really hard to assign actual songs as a ringtone on your phone. I think that's what started it. Because before the iPhone became like standard, that's all you saw was fucking commercials for ringtones.
Well, it's weird. People hate getting phone calls so much. There's nothing more annoying when someone calls you instead of texting you. But people still like ringtones.
I don't think anyone, I haven't heard like a ringtone.
There should be text tones.
I feel like the whole world's like 90% people keep it on vibrate now. Because they don't really want to answer.
I'm not even on vibrate. I'm on beneath that. It doesn't even move at all.
Nothing.
I find out later when I look at my phone that somebody either texted or called. But I never know in the moment.
Right.
There's a posse of at least 60 with video going in next door.
What is going on?
It's fucking amazing.
How do they fit?
Any rapper. That's what it is. Any rapper.
They have huge crews.
Yeah.
It's crazy. Man. A lot of people.
And their people are always texting someone.
It's
like their people always need to be somewhere else other than that. All right. What were we talking? Oh, we were talking about what before this, though, before I saw
Trump ringtones. Ringtones in general.
Oh, well, here's the thing. So Molly is looking for something in Boston. Her gig fell through, mm-hmm. and I had a name for her, a guy I talked to, so I gave her a call. And she was totally freaked out that I called without texting first. And she goes, your generation just calls. And I'm going like, why? Are you busy? No. But it's just weird to see my phone ringing.
Oh, yeah. There's normally, if for some reason you have to speak to someone on the phone, usually a text that says, can I call you? Are you free to talk?
Yes. I've done that. Can I call? Is call later? Or something like that. You set it up.
I just call. With Chris, he never gets a text. And then I get a freaked out, hey, boss, I don't know what the fuck is wrong with this. He's just fucking sending me freaked out texts. Sorry, boss, I don't know what the fuck.
Well, I don't know what's going on. Is everything okay?
What's what? You think I'm Springsteen?
I feel like if someone's calling, something terrible has happened. If someone's on the phone, whereas all other information and conversation happens through just text.
Here's the thing. I grew up with a landline. We didn't start crying every time the phone rang. We just fucking happens? Picked it up. Oh, my God.
Hello?
Ooh, who is it? Is it Grandma?
Send a telegram first.
You don't think that that people had, even back then, an opportunity just to say, hey, I got some bad news and this is it?
I don't know, because I used to I remember when I didn't have a cell phone and I would just call people instead of just texting them constantly.
That's how you spoke.
Yeah. But now it's just like,
but what
no.
are you worried about when you say, can I call now?
I'm not sure.
I'm not bothering you?
Bother? Yeah. It's a phone call.
I feel like every time the phone rings, I'm put on the spot.
Because when you're texting someone, when you're calling somebody, you know they're interrupting whatever they're doing. But when you text them, you know that they're the ones being rude to whoever they're probably sitting with. So right. It's really on them being the socially rude one texting back.
So the problem is the fact that the phone is always with you, where before you were just calling someone's home.
Right.
And, hey, can you talk? But people were watching television, or they were making sweet love, or they were taking Manitow and making their Coke available to sell uptown at a better profit. I mean, people were busy.
Yeah, they had stuff to do.
That.
And you didn't really have the same ability to silence the way we do now.
Or sidebar.
Sure.
Sidebar their ass.
I'll sidebar for almost anything.
Well, you don't answer things either.
I do answer.
I kind of feel like your phone is off most of the time.
That
I'm getting sidebarred quite a bit.
Oh, my God.
Do you answer if it's a number you don't recognize?
I sometimes will.
Never. No.
I answer Depends the phone on... in the hopes that I can keep them online.
What's up? How are you?
What's going on? And a lot of, for whatever reasons, it's like my phone number must be right in the middle of what's known as Hispanic Central. Because it's always Hispanics calling.
That's your wrong numbers, usually?
That's my wrong numbers,
me too,
yeah.
Me too. I don't know what. They have trouble getting the numbers right.
Dude, what about that weird thing where somebody contacted Chris about you?
Oh, yeah,
asking questions.
That was strange.
Like they were a job you wanted.
I just want to say, I was immediately suspicious of it. Chris, not suspicious at all. And then told him to contact you about it. And you know, it was like, what is this about? This doesn't make sense. And I was like, I told you.
And they were asking for info or something?
Yeah.
Like private info?
Yes, they were.
Remember that time with your grandmother?
That she was just telling me, like my other grandma, she was just telling me this weekend that the same shit happened to her. Some dude calls and says, hey, I'm your grandson. I'm in jail. I'm calling from jail. I need you to send money to bail me out. You know how they do the bail money just over email.
That's how they do it.
Yeah. Don't tell anybody. It will make it cheaper. They literally say to these older people, do not tell anyone or this is off the table.
So
I'm going to stay on the phone while you go and take the money out.
They just have this database of like little old ladies and Chris that they just try to scam.
Why are they so interested in me? Outside of I know the creditors. I know why they call. But the fucking random scammers?
The gullible.
Like, yeah.
The gullible geese.
I mean, how do they know your IQ? That's weird.
What? Bullshit.
They go for the simple.
he's sweet and simple.
He's just a simple man, simply with giant problems.
Everybody go check out Dan Perlman's show, Hindsight. It's happening tomorrow, May 10th, 7:30 at Caroline's Comedy Club in New York City. Go to carolines.com for tickets. And also, if you use the promo code had to be there, you're going to get free tickets.
Sweet.
Oh, sweet. Sean Patton, Joe List, John Lasseter, Janelle James. It's just great. It'll be great.
So Love it.
Tell us exactly what they're doing.
So they'll each get up and they'll tell some fun story, and then me and my co-host Billy will be on stage and we'll interject whenever we have questions or want to just riff or whatever. So the comic ends up riffing, and then we do a Q&A with the audience.
Does one of them get to win at the end of it?
No, not everything. It's not a competition. We're all just in it for the love.
So I just like when there's a winner and a loser. Yeah. I feel better about everything. All right, let's try it with Chris. Chris, you start to tell a story. And then we'll all be Dan in the middle of this.
Okay. So I was at a Christmas party last year.
I just want to jump in. Aren't you Jewish?
No, I'm Catholic.
You seem Jewish.
I'm Catholic.
Really?
Yes.
Then do the Lord's Prayer.
Our Father, who's in heaven. Our Father.
That's a question.
Our Father who's in heaven.
Right. This Coming is a regular who's on first.
Yeah.
Our Father who's in heaven.
So you think, feel like this
what's in purgatory?
Yeah.
Hallowed be thy name.
Aye, aye, aye.
I told you before. He's on first. Go ahead, tell your story.
Okay, so it was a Christmas party, and it was open bar, and I ended up drinking 2 bottles of vodka.
Wait, you're going to tell a story that we all already
know? We
know
this story.
Tell us a story that we don't know, so it can be interesting.
Okay.
Do the one where you and your buddy were blowing each other.
All right, so me and this guy, Jeff.
Jeff, huh?
We got tanked and sucked each other off.
Really?
No, it didn't happen.
My God.
I swear to God, it didn't happen.
You just said it. That was a story.
Hindsight's for true stories only.
Oh, fuck.
So it's true.
I just got hindsighted.
If you want to come tomorrow, you can tell that.
You had to beat it.
That's
the tell one of your stories. Tell I had to be this story.
Okay. I was at SUNY Albany. I was going to school there. I went up there just to party because it was Fountain Day.
What's Fountain Day?
I don't know what Fountain Day is. It's a party. It's time to party up there. And I'm drinking at this.
Well, all your stories are drinking, aren't they?
Oh, yeah. But most of them,
the glowing story, the Christmas story.
I know.
And I was moving some products while I was up there.
What products?
Pill form.
Okay, yeah.
What pills?
Let's say ecstasy, just for the sake of the story.
Are we going to say it?
What do we look like? Like a gathering of cops? Is this a police convention, or what are we doing?
I had some ecstasy.
Okay.
And, you know, some people want ecstasy, you know, when they don't have some.
Right. So how much were you selling it for?
$25 a pill.
Mm.
Okay.
And end up partying. I was at a sorority house, then I ended up at some bar, and then I black out and wake up in the back of a paddy wagon.
How much did you sell?
Oh, they were all gone by the time.
Can I just ask, this is a paddy wagon. What, were you busted in the 1930s? Who got you, a flat foot?
30s gangster move.
And then would we like them boom off the stage or something?
Yeah.
Apparently I got caught with a can of Molson Ice. I don't know why I was drinking that at the time.
Cool kid alert.
Yeah, right. Cool dude alert. Drinking Molson's in downtown Albany.
That's Fountain Day at its finest.
Yeah. I think it was Fountain Pen Day, if you looked into it. And then we were in the back of a paddy wagon. A couple of dirty coppers grabbed us.
I didn't even go to school here. And came
what?
To... I came to
that?
And
it's a random
SUNY Albany. Was
yeah, but why would you yell that? I don't even go to school here.
This can still be arrested.
They were weirded out by my
most
story.
Most people living in Albany don't go to school there.
It's weird.
And it's not.
It's the capital.
End up in the back of the paddy
wagon. Did they ignore this much when you try to help
out? This is unprecedented. But yeah. I want you to come. I want you to come. If you come tomorrow, I'll throw you up.
You're working with talented people, right?
Oh, the best.
Good.
Yeah. You going tomorrow, Chris?
Yeah, I'll go.
You going to tell your story?
I'll tell the story, sure.
Well, you did your impression in front of Dana Carvey, and that was cringy.
What impression?
You go ahead and do it.
California. California. John Doe's got the upper hand.
What other impression does he have? So afterwards, Carvey says to me, he goes, look, I got to run over and do an SNL. He goes, don't tell anybody. He goes, but between me and you, he goes, Was your fucking producer serious?
Yes.
And he goes, and I'm like, yeah, he's always serious. And he goes, did he even see the movie?
Come on, Dana. Did he really say that?
Yes. He was that totally ready. I can't wait till people hear this. It was so uncomfortable.
It's really uncomfortable.
And I, later that day, I'm
Gail's
like,
cringing. Her whole body is just uncomfortable.
I had bit into my lip until it bled.
I thought I did a great job, and I thought he was pleased with me.
Dude, and then Anthony's fucking Rocky went on forever. Yo, yo, how you doing, Adrian? Yo. Yo, Adrian, you're going to be able to do some stuff.
Then he was working him into the story, like, he was doing a little improv with
him. Yeah, Dana Carvey's here. Maybe he'd like to box with me a little bit, you know what I'm saying? Dana Carvey, I'll pump you up with my softball. It was fucking so cringe-inducing.
It was really sweet because he said, man, thanks so much for having me do that impression. He's like, I've been wanting to do that my whole life. And I was like, that's a really specific want that you've been having your whole life. Is it like, I've always wanted to
one
do this Rocky impression.
I want to do Rocky for carving. Yeah, like, if I got to wait my whole life, it's now so, I can die in peace.
So specific.
Queen Elizabeth said, good Lord, long story short, get to the dick in your mouth part, Hicks.
She's right.
And then I blow him
in the paddy wagon.
So I blowed a couple guys in the paddy
wagon. So you're going to go tomorrow night, Chris, for real?
I'll be there, yeah. I'll be there.
Do not embarrass the fucking show, though, okay?
No, please don't. Not like last time.
Wait, I realize you have to tell a story?
Yes.
Yeah, we'll throw
Why
it
else
up.
Would
yeah.
you go there? Just to watch other people?
I want
to watch
see
Joe List do it professionally?
Support Dan Perlman.
All right, that's very nice. Dan, great to see you again, buddy.
Thanks so much for having me.
And within
so
2 weeks, we're going to make the big announcement.
That'll be great. I can't wait for that.
We're going to need your help on it, too. I
mean, 100%.
Yeah, of course. He's the guy.
He's the guy behind
the guy. He's the guy behind the guy who's whispering in the guy's ear.
It's the most fun
he's
thing.
He's throwing around.
The plug for Dave Hill.
But he's not here yet, right?
Not yet, no.
Let's do the plug for Dan Perlman.
Yeah, exactly. Dan,
start with come visit me, Chris Stanley.
Come visit me, Chris Stanley, and the audience of Dan's show Hindsight. It's happening tomorrow, May 10th, 7:30 p.m. at Caroline's Comedy Club in New York City. The promo code is had to be there for free tickets. Go to carolines.com.
Had to be there, and then we'll tweet that out. Had to be there.
All one word.
All one word. One crazy word.
Caps.
Yeah.
Caps.
And me, Chris Stanley, buy him a drink, see if he takes it.
Buy me club soda.
Taunt fucking Chris Stanley and his sobriety. We'll be right back. Hey, giving away a signed copy of Dave Hill Doesn't Live Here Anymore by Dave Hill. It's all for first responders. Right back, Bennington Show. Dave Hill Doesn't Live Here Anymore. That's the new book available tomorrow, May 10th, in stores and online. Reddit. Loved it. You're a terrific writer, Dave.
Thank you so much.
It's so good.
Thank you. I'm honored.
You know, the last time we saw you, we lost Prince. We
yeah,
saw you the second.
Seconds after the yeah. news broke, I ran right into your arms.
Yeah, it was the weirdest thing, wasn't
arms.
It?
That's
yeah.
exactly what happened.
It's four arms, which is
it was.
Yeah. It's just really uncomfortable.
Yeah. But yeah, it was...
And then Amy Miller was with us. She's like, I'm too young to remember. No, she wasn't. She felt just as bad.
Yeah.
But
it was good to be with friends.
Yes.
I'm thinking that could be the in the next book, you know, because you use your life for your book.
Yes. Where I was when Prince died. Well, someone dies in every book, it seems.
Yeah, so. Someone has to.
Someone has to die.
Which is a great title from a book. Someone
gotta give
has
the next
well,
die.
That's, you know, that's what I'm always up against with this is my second book. And yeah. Though I don't hear it a lot. I mean, so the first book, the reviews are really nice. And so far people are saying nice things about this, but I'm like, oh man, you know, some people are like, can't, you know, he didn't get shot in the face or
right.
have to live in a ditch. You know, I need some more adversity.
Well, no, you know why? Because there is a relatable thing to your writing because it's suburban, right? There's a yeah. lot of suburban and move to the city stuff. And that is kind of an entire generation, maybe even more than one generation, who understands that lifestyle.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, I think it's relatable. And I mean, that's what's fun for me is writing about. I mean, I like writing about going to a Mexican prison and
yeah.
working for Donald Trump for one day. Things like that, that you're like, oh, I should write about that. But then sort of the more fun is, yeah, sort of examining
the Donald Trump chapter
mundane stuff.
Yeah, it's hysterical because at the time it's 2004.
Yeah.
So you're just like, hey, I'm working for the rich guy on TV.
Right. But, harmless.
Yeah. But yeah. But now imagine if you're a thing like, hey, somebody spent the day with Nixon. That would be a fascinating, crazy story. And that's maybe what happened with you.
But, do you feel like maybe secretly you kind of hope that he gets elected so that turns into a presidential story as opposed to...
I don't know. I think... I was just visiting my dad and we were talking about it and he's like, I kind of would like... And my dad's a Republican, but like more of an old school, like, you know, fiscally conservative, not a racist type.
Yeah.
You know, the more 80s, 70s, 80s.
Small government, you know,
the more
support business.
Not the stuff we think of first when you hear that word. But anyway, he was like, I don't think he's going to, I think he'll vote for Hillary. But not that he told me that. But with Trump, he's like, I'd like to see it just for the comedy. I mean, like we'd all like to see that.
Well, you got to have the third act. I mean, we have to see how this ends.
But it would be interesting for, to be like the day I worked for a president before. But even with that piece, you know, I feel like it's pretty clear what I think about Trump in that piece. But if I were to write it today, it would have been like much meaner.
Because
I wrote it sometime in the last year. And we were still in the phase of like, this is never going anywhere.
Right. This is absurd.
But you know, I've heard from people who have met him that it's not unlike you, where it's, you know, that he was pleasant, that he was kind of, you know, he knows how to work a small social circle.
Yeah.
You know, I've never, I met that guy and he treated me like shit.
No, he was, he was... He was very nice to me, which I write about.
Yeah.
The whole thing. Thank you. They just brought coffee in for the listener. But just that, like, the one thing I liked about him, if I had to find something, was that there was a part of him where you're like, oh, he's playing this asshole.
Right.
Like he knows what he's doing. And like you kind of get the feeling, which I still hope that, you know, at the 11th hour, he's going to go, hi, I was just kidding.
Yeah. He still kind of feels a little bit like a professional wrestler.
Yeah.
He
feels
like he's cutting promos when he's talking about other candidates. It doesn't quite feel like he could be a real person.
Well, he doesn't get his feelings hurt when people say mad things about him. You know what I mean? He'll still end up doing stuff. But at the same time, he realizes, like, I'm going to attack strengths as well as weaknesses.
Yeah.
Like, Hillary's big with women. I'm going to come out and say Hillary's terrible to women. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And he knows he's not going to win that. But if he just takes some of those votes, he's happy. Who's the rap star getting all the pictures over here?
I don't know, but it's like...
Do we know, Joe?
It's Akon or Akon. I'm not being intentionally
Acorn.
Stupid.
It's Acorn.
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 Well, okay, you. But I didn't. When I was coming up here, there were a lot of guys and cameras and an entourage and stuff, and this one guy who seemed to be the focal point of it, and I was like, well, that's someone really cool.
Yeah, that's somebody happening. They're in the middle of the storm.
Who.
That's why these guys know to put themselves in the middle of all this. Even before their stuff starts to move. Like a guy who just have his first record out will come in with 30 people, you know?
That's the move, right?
Yeah.
I'm so stupid. Like, I was at South by Southwest a couple years ago, and I was doing stuff, hosting, like, the Spotify house.
Mm-hmm.
And they had DJs come in, like, guys who all they had to do was, like, hook up their laptop or something and then walk away.
Right.
And they still had, like, 10 people.
Yeah.
Just for emotional support, I guess.
Yeah, but I would, like, you go, I'm like, I gotta start. But then the reality is, like, who would follow me around all day?
I don't know.
There's maybe a couple people.
We could do it for a while. I don't know if we could do it every day.
You guys
day.
Are friends. You would do it. You know, maybe you'd give me 20 minutes here and there. But
yeah, just pop in.
Then it's always funny to me, like, Graham Nash will come in by himself. You know what I mean? And he'll be like, I just got off the train. And I'll be like, well, that guy sold 100 million records in his
that's
life.
The ultimate power move is like, you know, not to take anything away from Akon, he's the best. Yeah. I've never heard him, but I bet he's great.
Yeah.
But, you know, that sort of thing is probably fleeting, but
yeah.
Well, Graham Nash
is, you know, from Akon, you know, mighty oaks grow. That's what I say. So that could be.
Wait, isn't he on that song, the Gwen Stefani, the woo?
Oh, is that him?
Is it?
He on that, the Gwen Stefani?
Can we have a run person run a check on this?
That one?
She's got a song out that said, if you thought I really sold out before, wait till you see where I am now with pop music. I've really... Is this him?
He's on a song with her called The Sweet Escape.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
I don't remember what he does on that song, but I do love that song. I got no beef with Gwen Stefani.
Good.
Big fan.
Good.
An actual beef?
No, I said I have no beef.
Oh, you have no beef.
I mean, like, I feel like she's... there's never been a time when I'm like, well, I don't love that. And I,
were you a holla back girl though? Were you a holla back girl?
I gotta be honest, I was not.
Yeah.
And, but sometimes you'd be like, I'll have to step aside and be like, hey, this one's not for me. This isn't about me all the time.
Well, I'll do that with the biggest artist, you know, but I mean, nobody. It's always amazing to me where you're like, oh, John Lennon is a great songwriter. Hey, this one stinks. Yeah, and he still put it out. I always love that. That's one of my favorite thing of that they're not all great.
That's, I kind of like a band that does, like Cheap Trick is one of my favorite bands, but like not the greatest batting average in rock, really. Like first four or five albums and then...
But if you look, well, by the way, go listen to their last album that they just put out like a month ago. It sounds like it came out in 78, 79.
Okay, I got to check this out.
Really,
I do keep up with them, but I've not heard that one.
But if you take, let's say most acts that you're going to see, 90% of the set is the first four or five albums. 90%.
Yeah.
I don't care who it is.
If they're doing it right.
Yeah.
I saw, maybe I probably took, because whenever anything vaguely resembling this, I probably said this on the show before, but I saw Paul McCartney. Did I tell you this?
No, I think.
I saw him at Outside Lands in San Francisco like a couple summers ago. And this is a guy who could just play T-ball with the hits. Just like he's written, he could play, I'm just going to do a set of some of the biggest songs of the last 200 years.
Right.
And I wrote all of them. And instead, he's like, this next one I wrote for my wife. And he's not talking about Linda McCartney. He's talking about his current wife.
Yeah.
He's like, you're a monster. Like, what? Just play all these great songs that you have locked and loaded.
Yeah.
Morrissey's like that, too, if you like the Smiths at all. He aggressively is like, oh, you want to hear all those great songs I wrote? I'm going to play the new album.
Right. But see, unlike a lot of musicians, you do stand-up. Nobody wants to hear the old stuff in stand-up.
No.
You know what I mean? No one feels nostalgic about their stand-up. That's a weird
it's frowned
thing.
Upon.
Yeah.
No.
If you were to go back to old material.
And I'm freaking out because I've been writing this book, and now I have to go, I'll do this book tour coming up starting tomorrow, and then I'll go do comedy shows, and I'm going to, like, doing a week of shows in London. And London, like, if you show up in the UK without a brand new show every time, they're like, what do you do all day? Like you were here 3 months ago and you did this show. Like, why are you doing the same show again?
Well, the problem with London is they had Oscar Wilde. So they just think that people are incredibly witty and brilliant. And this is something people do. This is something one does, isn't it?
Yeah. So anyway, freaking out.
You know, you got this, you're doing this book tour, but I was over at Gail's house yesterday. And she breaks out your last book, which she had signed.
Oh,
and I go, where did
you
get that? And you went to...
I went to the party at the Bell House when you did the book release.
Oh, yeah.
And I showed him that you signed it for me. And I think what you wrote was, Gail, I hope you enjoy my typing.
Is that a go-through? Is that one of your go-to? Yeah.
Maybe when I'm feeling... Maybe when my self-esteem is low, which is often.
Yeah.
But it's like a vague reference to a Truman Capote
quote where he refers to
someone.
Kerouac.
Yeah, it was Kerouac. Yeah, exactly.
So,
that's typing, not writing.
Yeah, so.
Do you know what the...
Depending on my mood.
On the road thing, I saw the scroll. I saw the scroll that he typed the entire thing out on, and they had it laying across the floor, and you could walk along and just see that it was all done on this one big industrial thing that he had taped together a couple times.
Yeah.
It was crazy.
And it was it just stained with whiskey and
it was stained and it was
blood.
It's actually owned by the owner of the Colts, the Indianapolis Colts, that Pillhead. He owned it. And there it is right there. It's laid out.
Holy
and that,
shit.
That was, I think, at the New York Public Library, right? Yeah. That's where I went and saw it.
That is
but it was
so cool.
Crazy. Here's the other thing that they had as part of this. When he was a little kid, in his mind, he made up a baseball league, right? Of who all the teams were. Then he went down and did box scores all the way through. And it was like 25 teams and an imaginary league over the course of a summer.
Imaginary players?
Yeah, imaginary players, imaginary teams, imaginary everything. And he did that in like his, preteens.
So that's like next level fantasy baseball.
Yeah.
Like
yeah.
The teams and the players don't even... That I respect.
Yeah.
The one that people actually do... concerns me.
Yeah. It should.
But if you had seen that your kid had done that, would you be like, okay, he's really obsessive? Or you'd be like, okay, I have some sort of strange genius.
Both.
Yeah.
You do both. You just go like, just like jacking off, just like do it in your room, dude. Don't do it in front
it's like,
of everyone.
Yeah, you don't have to tell everyone about it.
That's
very progressive. From my upbringing, we still haven't talked about it, me and my dad. He does jacking off. No.
Even though
he thinks I'm working on my hair.
It's very important to him.
Yeah.
He's up there for hours at a time.
Well, your dad is all through this book, and in the trailer for the book, you're playing Zeppelin with your dad, which is pretty amazing.
Yeah, I just shot that last weekend.
That's pretty cool.
And it's my dad, I write about it in the book, my dad, he's 83. He just decided he plays the piano and he's usually learning like classical or like ragtime, and he's like, I want to learn Stairway to Heaven. So it wasn't like I was egging him on,
right?
It was just like he just learned it and I knew it, so we were like, oh, we should play it together.
There's this great moment where he takes a moment to turn the page and kind of just look into the camera somewhat patiently waiting for him to pick it back up again.
It's real. I mean, the thing is, we shot that. It's all one. My dad just played the song once, and then he let me play. I was like, oh, you gotta let me play the end. So then we played the ending through a couple times. So it's really him just one take and me sitting in at the end, and he plays this. It's weird because at first I was like, oh, this will be funny, I'll play the electric guitar with my 83-year-old dad and ruin his song or whatever. But then he played the song and it's like kind of super powerful until I come in the end. But he's just like playing this extra dirgy version of Stairway to Heaven.
Yeah.
And he's genuinely like reading the sheet music and like turning the pages. And I was like, oh man, like I don't even think I should be in this video. It was great.
I was weird. I was just watching this thing that John Bryan was saying, and I don't know how old it was. It was some interview with him saying that he believed that there were performance pieces and there were songs. And a performance piece had to be done by that person in that time for it to be great. And you use Led Zeppelin, their entire catalog, as performance pieces. You really don't want to cover that music.
Right.
It stands about those people playing those instruments at that time. And then a song, which is like Gershwin or Paul McCartney, where it can be replayed time and time again.
Who would you say is an artist that cannot be covered?
Well, I was actually thinking that Dylan has both. Dylan has songs that are only Dylan songs.
Yeah.
And then songs that should be done and sung by everybody.
Yeah, that's totally.
Which is kind of bizarre.
Yeah, some of them are just his own.
Yeah.
I think even though he writes for other people and he's a great songwriter, I think that Elvis Costello was really hard to cover because
I think
he has the most impossible voice. Like, it's so specific. Like, it has high and low notes at the same time. Like, if you ever, like, just try to, like, sing along with an Elvis Costello song and you're like, I sound like shit. Like, why can't I sing along with that?
And then he has, like, this snottiness that you can't replicate, really.
Right.
Yeah. But then he's just like, I saw him years ago, like in an outdoor venue in Cleveland, and it was like on the river, like, you know, 5,000 people. And then he's, you know, he's like playing, and then he's like, I'm just going to sing a cappella with no microphone for a song and see how, and it's like, oh, everyone can hear you for 10 miles. Yeah. You can sing your ass off.
I know. Yeah. I've seen him we do that before too. Yeah.
I can't remember where that was in Florida.
It was
right?
in Florida, yeah. At a thing, and he just stepped away and just started singing, and it was
so powerful, and it's amazing his voice. Like,
yeah, some people just have like, it's like they're just born with like cannons.
Well, they're born with that, but then you look into a lot of people that their parents were singers, right?
Yeah.
So they taught them how to sing properly.
Right.
Not like I sing from the highest part of my throat that I possibly can. Yeah. You know? I'm trying to think. Daryl Hall's mom was a singer and teacher, and that's why I don't know what he is, 69 or something, and still can sing soul music.
Yeah.
You know, it's always amazing to me.
Voice. I'm friends with the Wainwright family.
God.
And like those, all of them can sing their balls off, even the women.
I know.
Balls. No, but like Lucy Wainwright Roach was in my apartment years ago when I was living in Brooklyn, and I just heard like this, the whole apartment was like vibrating practically. And she was just sitting in a chair humming. It was just like, and it was just like, they're equipped with these.
Well,
you know.
Have you ever been to their Christmas shows where the whole family comes out and does different Christmas songs? And it's just the amount of talent is crazy.
I can do one better. I've done. They, Suzzy Roach from the Roaches, who's Lucy's mom and was married or dated Loudon, and they had a kid together. She has a party just at her apartment, and I went and I had too much to drink, as these things go. And all three, the Roaches are there. All three sisters are there. And do you know that song, One Season, by them? It's on their first or second album. And it's, you know, the Roaches sing in this, for the listener, you should seek them out, like 70s folk, like three women, 70s folk, like on. This is a description of it. I would never be into it, but then you hear them and it's like, oh my God, they're incredible. And so they sang this song, and I was like, do you think, I asked Lucy, I was like, do you think they would let me sing? There's like this high, like, there's like this solo coming out of the break. Do you like, do you think they would let me sit in with them and sing it? And I did, and I butchered it, but it's still the happiest moment of my life.
Right.
I have just like an iPhone recording of it, and it's just like, and the best part is everyone at the party, because everyone's getting up all night, like singing serious, like sing, you know, Loudon's getting up, all these people are getting up and singing for real and like sounding great. And they're like, well, who's this drunk guy sitting with the Roaches who's going to sing now? And like most people there don't know me. And so I sing this thing, and you can hear in the recording, like, half the people know, like, oh, that's Dave being an idiot. And then the other half are like, we don't know if we're allowed to laugh or not. And once they realize that it's a joke, there's like this laugh. And then there's all these people like, oh, thank God I can laugh openly at this idiot, because that was horrible.
So, you know Rufus?
Yeah.
God.
He's incredible.
I think he's one of the few people that I would literally say is a musical genius walking amongst us today.
Yeah.
Like literally, where you look at him and go, that's, I think the art teacher, that song, The Art Teacher, is better than most movies in terms of story telling.
I can listen to 10, 15 seconds of that and immediately start crying.
Sure.
Like, that song just sets me off.
Yeah. It's like what the story of, having an art teacher as a kid and then like growing up. And it's sort of, I guess, from the perspective of a woman.
Of a woman,
falling in love with this art teacher and then eventually going on to be like this society woman who has...
Yeah. Here I am in this uniform, this pantsuit sort of thing.
It's such a good
So thing. Descriptive and great and fantastic. And it just, for him, it's just like another song. Like, it's just, I mean, his songs are so great that that's like one in 20 that'll just sing that, you know, It's crazy.
And then when we had him in not too long ago, he was working on the opera that he had.
You're right.
Which is just crazy.
So we were playing a little bit of the opera, and then he came in, and he sat with us, and you just see him close his eyes as he's listening, and you're like, okay, he even listens to music better than people. You know what I mean? Like, he's feeling it. It's like if you meet somebody who has extra taste buds or something, his ability to listen is... But what about out of his new stuff? Have you heard that song Montauk that he's singing to his kid?
Oh, yeah. It's about him and his husband.
Yeah. Like, when you get older, come out.
Yeah.
Oh, God. It's so amazing.
Good. Yeah. He's a great lyricist as well.
Well, he said that thing to us. He said that it can't be a great song. It's not a great song without a great lyric. And then for a month, I went around testing it wherever I could. And I could only think of Wild Thing, and somebody else even brought up Wild Thing to me, where I'm like, this is a great song, and the lyric is stupid.
Yeah. You know? But then it's tricky, because sometimes you go, going back to Elvis Costello, like, his songs don't have that super narrative. It's like a bunch of lines.
Yeah, but
I love his lyrics, man.
They're great, but they're not
poetic. Like if I think
absolutely, but it's a different, like... It's not like the art teacher where you're like, okay,
I totally get it. Yeah.
Like, his is more like you have to kind of piece it together and think about it.
Yeah, and I think that they're kind of like a little bit more, not absurd, but they seem to kind of come like randomly or, you know. But I think he's very poetic.
Well, Elvis Costello, it's always fun for me to figure out the people that you sing their songs in attempt to do their voice. And Elvis Costello, instead of singing like yourself, you're doing an Elvis Costello impression. Neil Young is the same way. Oh, I dreamed I saw. No one just sits there and sings it like themselves.
It would be boring to try to sing that in your own voice.
And suddenly you're acting like, this is what I'd be singing like if I was Neil Young. It's crazy. And Neil has the same kind of lyrics where you're like, I think I know what he's talking about, but I'm not sure.
Right.
I think that's the kind of writing that people do from a subconscious place, you know, that they just trust that these are the lyrics. I don't think Paul Simon does that at all. I think Paul Simon writes that way and then comes back and rewrites those lyrics over and over,
mm-hmm.
you know.
But he's done all right for himself, too.
He's done
in his minor defense.
Yeah.
He's doing okay.
Yeah. I hate to disagree with Art Garfunkel, who I think is a wonderful man, but I like some of the stuff that Paul's done as a solo artist.
Graceland I could do without, only because it's like, I feel like it just comes at you when you don't need it. Like, you're... Your life, something bad just happened. You get in a car accident.
Right.
Not now.
My favorite is Hearts and Bones. That album slays me. Although I don't like every song on the album, the high water marks on that album I'll put against any album that's ever been done.
Yeah. He's great.
I don't know where I'm going to do that at, though. You know what I mean? I wish I wish people took this as serious as I
do. You got to set it up. Be like, what are you doing tonight? Oh, well, I wasn't going to say anything, but Ron's actually going to go toe-to-toe with someone about this Paul Simon album.
We need to do that more.
Great
just
debate.
Daniel, the devil and Daniel Webster over things that don't matter to most people.
I like that. It could even just be like sort of like in the old-timey salon tradition. Like, well, today we're going, there's a, somewhere on the Upper West Side, there's a cocktail party, and Ron's going to tear somebody a new one about Paul Simon.
Dave Hill's new book.
That's the world I want
to
live in.
Yeah, me too.
Dave Hill's new book, Dave Hill Doesn't Live Here Anymore, is available tomorrow, May 10th, in stores and online. Go to DaveHillOnline.com for more information. And you can listen to him, the goddamn Dave Hill Show, every Monday night at 9 p.m. on WFMU.
He's such a funny man. The writing here is great. And like I said, there are things that we all relate to. Boxing gloves, that thing when you're a kid. And your fantasy is tested by yourself, I think is something that we've all gone through before.
Yeah. I mean, that's that story. I mean, that's the kind of stuff I tried to hone in on this book. But this, yeah, the story with that is like having this delusion beyond not just a fantasy of like being like, I'd be a really good boxer like the guys on TV. I mean, I begged my dad not to ruin the whole story, but the gist of it, I begged my dad to buy me boxing gloves, which my friends all use to kick my ass.
But I think kids do that so much where when you're a kid, you get into that thing where you go through like these really intense phases where you're mm-hmm. like, that's the new me. Like you're searching right. so hard for an yeah. identity. So if it's a genre of music, if it's a sport, like whatever it is, you see that thing and you're like, that's gonna be my new life. I'm gonna be that guy. Like when I was a kid, for some reason, I decided that I wanted to be a horn player of some sort. And then I, you know, my music teacher said that the only thing they didn't have in the band was a trombone. Mm-hmm. And I was like, that's it. I'm going to be a trombone player.
That's
and,
a badass
and,
instrument.
I did like maybe one to two lessons. And she said, you're really not good at this. And
really?
She's like, you don't even have the lung capacity to play this instrument. It's too big for you. You will never be a trombone player. And I remember I went home and told my parents and they're like, hey, you know, that's the kind of thing that, you know, somebody says that to you and then you push harder. And I was like, nope, that's it. I'm going to take exactly what she said to heart.
Yeah, now I'm going to take the lesson. We lost a trombone grade. Yeah. That's what I heard. I flunked... I was the only one who failed music in grade school one quarter or semester or whatever. And like, you know, not that I'm a wildly successful musician, but I think I'm probably the most successful from my eighth grade class.
Yeah.
It's not saying anything. Yeah. Just saying there's been more downloads. But yeah, they failed me. So I'm just saying you might want to, if the trombone is still around.
Here's the thing too, like... Even if you've never made platinum albums, you're sitting us telling us, oh, I'm at this party with the Roaches and Rufus Wainwright. That's the thing that art's supposed to take you to, right? Isn't that supposed to just be this, I sold more records than anybody else, but to give you a life worth discussing?
Yeah, that
you know?
Has way more
moments.
Value.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I think, well, that's what I tell myself, too. I was just telling someone earlier, because they're like, it seems like you get up to some... crazy stuff or whatever, you know, because they were asking about the when I went to the Mexican prison, and I was like, well, I gotta do that stuff. I mean, that just kind of comes about organically or whatever, but it's like, until they're asking me to do a sitcom or something, I gotta entertain myself,
right?
You know, by going to Mexican prison or Christmas party or something.
Well, what I love about the Mexican thing is you were scared as anybody would be, you mm-hmm. know what I mean? Like a lot of people think, well, that Dave, he'll go and do these crazy things. He's fearless. No. No, it's a scary thing to do.
Yeah, I only went because my brother, whom I love and respect, was like, yeah, do it. And if you get killed, you won't care. You'll be dead.
Right.
So I was like, well, that weirdly makes a lot of sense. I was like, probably the murder part is going to suck. But once the murder's over, you don't care.
That is, I think, true of any death. As bad it is, dying is the bad part.
Right.
And then after that is as natural as waking up. You know what I mean?
Like getting a tattoo, I imagine. Not that I have one or ever will. But they say it hurts. And afterwards, you're like, look, that's
look
a
this.
Dragon.
Yeah.
It's really like a dragon.
This represents when my dad left Korea. Really? This is a story? Now you're... these aren't just cool tattoos?
Do you guys have tattoos?
Gail does.
I do.
Do you? No, and this is... I'm all for tattoos on other people. But, I almost got one of my mom's name was Bunny. And so I was like, and after she died, I was like, I'm going to get a bunny and that'll be to remember her by. And then I was like, well, then I'm going to be a guy with just a rabbit on my arm that everyone else is just like, why do you have a rabbit on your arm? And so I didn't get it.
Yeah.
I think it works. I think what happened was that's how, like, a phase tattooing was like that, where people kind of got these very, like, emotional tattoos, or they're like, this symbolizes this and it means this, and this is why I got it. And then I think that there was a backlash, and then I feel like a lot of people my age started to just be like, no, I'm going to get just like visual things that I like to look at, funny things, things that made me laugh. And they went like maybe too far in the opposite direction.
Yeah. Yeah.
Where they're just like, I just got this tuna fish sandwich because it's funny. And you're like, yeah, that's funny too. So I feel like I was part of a backlash movement of the meaningful tattoo.
Do you have a tuna fish sandwich?
A couple of tuna fish sandwiches.
See, I always say, I mean, I like to see the occasional stupid tattoo, whatever, but I'm with all of it. I'm just like the tuna fish. Just get like a t-shirt and wear that day. And then
you
like
make a good parent, because that's something parents say often.
Well, the big thing is you always see like someone. I had a friend, like she went through a bad breakup and then she had no tattoos, and I was getting coffee with her and she had like some quote from literature on her arm, like somewhere where she herself could never see it. And I was like, what is that? She's like, it says, and she's trying to bend it arm to read it, and she can't read it. And she's like, it just like gives me strength. And I was like, and who wrote that? And it's like Proust or whatever. And I was like, you know what books are for, right? You just can't, like, you're like, yeah. I'm going to pull down that Proust and check it out. Oh, yeah, that's pretty great. Put it back
that
on the shelf.
That still means something to me.
Do you know how much money we can make if we came up with some way of dealing with heartbreak, though? Because it's the weirdest thing that when someone else is telling you about their heartbreak, you can't relate, even though you've been through it yourself.
Yeah.
And you're just like, hey, start, you know, dating other people. Or,
yeah, because
you know,
when you're in it, it's the worst thing.
It's terrible.
That could ever happen to a person. And when you're outside of it, you have all the answers. You're just like, come on, dude. She sucked anyway. You're just acting like
what
it's
you need is a blowjob. Like, you're not even helpful.
That's great advice, though, I think. And for whatever happens. Because you're right. That's always going to make, that would help. Right. Whatever's happening.
Yeah, it would make it at least temporarily better.
Temporary is the truth of all of it. It just pushes it off until later.
Yeah, you can only have, you know, so much whiskey and blowjobs.
Yeah.
You know, that'll tide you over for a few months.
Yeah, but it doesn't even matter if you've been through it. You never remember that, like, in a year or two, this really isn't going to feel like much of anything. Like, it, like eventually...
There's still some of them that you're like, I wonder...
Yeah, but not ever... Yeah, yeah, but you think about them... You don't, like, think about them all the time.
I
like,
wonder
maybe
what
you come
Meredith
up...
Baxter Burney's doing now.
Yeah, you might just have...
I don't
like,
know why I picked her.
She's with a woman. She's doing very well. Yeah.
Is she? I guess we all saw it coming.
Yeah. You know, I didn't.
Enough
and,
Lifetime
but
movies.
Very happy about it, though. I was like, you know what? You deserve this later in life.
Yeah. I don't know why her name came to mind.
You know, it's
I
the
guess
perfect
it's
a... name for breakup.
Yeah. It is.
Meredith Baxter Burney.
She's just, no one, everyone's like, who?
Chris, you're lucky. You never had to deal with a major breakup.
I had one in college that was a major breakup.
And that's it?
Yeah, that was it, yeah.
Are you married now?
No.
Might as
so
well
are you
her, right? That's the way you
are. You in a relationship?
Yeah, long time relationship.
Because we never see her.
No,
where's
she's
she
not
been?
Around much. Storia.
That's how you make it work. Mm. She's not around much.
Is that what it is?
There you go.
Long term
fondness, you know.
Long distance, long term. Like the Clintons. They were very happy because they were never near each other.
Yeah.
You know?
And they had, I think, their own set of rules that worked for them.
I think we know what those rules are.
Yeah.
Feels like I can do whatever I want, and you'll live with the kid. What's the kid's name?
Chelsea.
She woke up in a Chelsea morning. But I think if it says we both can have girlfriends, I think everybody can relax.
It's
when you bring a dude into it that he starts going, you know what, I want this and that.
What's that mean?
Yeah, girlfriends are always so much easier for everybody in the relationship, and I'm sure he'll...
Everybody gets a girlfriend.
Everybody gets a girlfriend. That's it.
That's how you make it work.
But I, you know, when you're a kid, even when you're a little kid, you can have a breakup that makes every cell in your body hurt. You can be in, when people go, oh, he's going through puppy love. I'm going, nope. That's as bad as a divorce when you're in third grade.
Oh, yeah.
And the girl doesn't like you back.
I still, in high school, that's when I really... I had my heart broken the worst, and I just couldn't even wrap my head. Still, I still struggle with
it. I had a ninth grade one that was that bad that it felt like this will never end.
Yeah.
Never. And that's the age that you got to really look out for kids. Like, you know what I mean? Where you got to do the hold on loosely. Like, you know, all right, We're just going to chill. Keep your door open, though. Make sure you're not eating a bunch of pills in there. And then it's also where you got to watch out if you have a daughter that the boys get weird. Well, you always got to watch out that when a boy during a breakup will do something that he would instantly regret, you know?
Oh, you mean the boyfriend of your daughter?
Yeah.
Like burn a pentagram onto your lawn.
Yeah, I mean, that would be the good
just
part.
Just as an for instance.
Yeah, that would be the easy version.
Yeah.
Because a lot of kids, they get so fucking crazy. But my theory is the person that you broke up with, they don't look at you the same way again, right? They don't give you that same kind of attention, you know? And then when it's not there, you're like, wait, you're not being yourself.
Yeah.
First, look like you used to, and then let me describe this.
if nothing has changed for you.
Yeah, nothing has changed.
Oh, it's awful.
Yeah.
I mean, I had one in high school where the guy broke up with me to go back to his previous girlfriend.
Who he told you sucked.
Yeah. Who, you know, I was pretty sure sucked. I think we both agreed on that. And somehow then you start being like, so what seemed like sucked is better? Like, that's better? Like, it was horrible. It was just completely
high school's bad, too, because you still see each other.
Oh, yeah,
it's like
that's
when you're an
worst.
Adult, you can go into
we
different
had
worlds.
Same circle of friends, and it was awful.
You have the same hallway.
Yeah.
You know, you turn around, it's like if you got divorced, but then here's your wife coming down the hall, hugging someone else. So
we're going
happy.
To lunch.
But then then when you get to be an adult, it like flips because then, well, like there's a period where people are getting married and you have to be like, don't, what are you, are you crazy? What are you doing?
And then you're talking the last one doing that.
Yeah. But like, well, I always say, like, I guess it changes as I get older, but the first wave of friends who got married, and a couple still are, but, you know, when they tell, I like women don't understand that, like, because like when they tell people that they got engaged, they're like, I got engaged. But like, I'm like, every guy friend of mine that's told me he's engaged told me like he got cancer or something.
Right.
He's just like, I don't know how to tell you this, but I'm getting married.
You know?
And I'm like, what? I'm so sorry. What happened? He's like, well, we were just looking. We did our taxes and realized. Be cheaper if we got married and
until he's like,
health insurance. And,
I owe this girl. I can't tell you how she bailed me out.
Yeah.
Now she's asking for this one thing. Why not give it to her? You know, it's easy.
I mean, she'll leave if I don't.
Yeah. She'll leave. She makes me food and stuff.
Yeah.
Ugh. I need food. For something.
Yeah. But we literally think that's the only way to live. We still think... Okay, and then you, as soon as you're done, then you become a mommy and daddy.
Yeah.
You know? And anything outside of that is frowned upon. Anything.
Yeah.
It's frowned upon.
It's weird because you kind of wonder what is going to be that next taboo lifestyle. You know, certainly I think we've made so many advancements in the way society views gay marriage and gay relationships. But it's like, what is going to be that next thing of just like people who don't want to be monogamous or people who are into polygamy? Like,
yo,
there's
I think
like,
you mean all guys.
Right.
Like, maybe that will be the next thing that we're like, let's stop treating this like it's a weird thing. And let's
you know what?
Like,
I mean, there's enough group houses in Brooklyn now where you could see that at some point, how is that not the same as a marriage? If you have four people living together, sharing things, blah, 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 that breakup is eventually, you know, if it goes on for years, is going to be as hard of who owns what as anything else.
Yeah.
You know?
I had two girlfriends who, like, they lived together for something like 8-9 years. And, like, when the one was like, yeah, I'm getting in this pretty serious relationship, I'm probably going to get engaged, so I have to move out. It was like really heartbreaking. They're like, they had like a really difficult time. They were trying to figure out how to split everything up. There was like a lot of crying. It was
difficult.
I would
have just set the place on fire.
I like what you're doing. I like what you're doing, Dave.
Dave Hill's new book, Dave Hill Doesn't Live Here Anymore, is available tomorrow, May 10th, in stores and online. Go to DaveHillOnline.com for more information and listen to him, the goddamn Dave Hill Show, every Monday night at 9 p.m. on WFMU.
Well, he writes books, he writes songs, he writes stand-up comedy. He does podcasts. Anything but a real job. Anything.
That's you know, going back to disappointing your family across the board.
Yeah.
You see me at a family reunion, I'm at the kids' table. The whole deal.
Well, I remember scaring people with this when I started to explain to my friends what the weird uncle is when you're a kid. And that's the uncle who comes back that doesn't have a family, but he's there at Thanksgiving and Christmas. And all the kids just, they don't say it, but they know that he's peculiar.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I had my nephew who's now, I think, like 9 or something, but a few years ago, my sister lives in Boston, and she's like, oh, I just, her son, William, she's like, he had a friend over, and, you know, I told him that you were going to be coming over, and he went to his friend, he said, you got to meet my Uncle David, he's different. Yeah. And the kid was like, yeah, 5 at the time. I'm like, how could he possibly, what is he picking up on? Like, he doesn't know about jobs, yeah, and like, and then, you know, yeah, and then my niece, one, she was like 4 and talking about, she's like, I want to be a maid of honor, or no, a flower girl, whatever the, yeah, flower girl. And like, is anyone going to get married? And my brother's like, well, your Uncle David, like, maybe he could get married. And the 4 or 5-year-old's like, no, he's not ready. Like, what about, who else? What, yeah, you, other siblings do you have?
What are the, I'm other,
like,
options here?
Yeah, I'm like, I'm getting insulted by, well, preschoolers.
See, that's the difference. I think now if you wait and you stay single, it's people that are like, oh, well, he's not accepting adulthood. But my uncles that were single, you know, they would smoke in the dark. You know what I mean? They were just, something horrible happened somewhere. And they were just, you just go by and you just see a dark room, just one little red glow would be, oh, I love, fuck.
Do you know what that, anytime, I've since been, it's been explained to me that now, you know, cab drivers, when they're talking on the phone incessantly, yeah, someone explained, they're like, oh, they're talking to other cab drivers. But until that was explained to me, invariably, I'm like, somewhere in the world, there's a guy smoking in the dark. Because, you know, the cab drivers are like, yeah, they never stop talking for the other person. They're just, yeah, like, blah, 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 blah. And then, so I always imagine, like, somewhere on the other side of the world, there's a guy sitting smoking in the dark just going, and then what happens? And then the guy just keeps going.
And she knew you were mad.
I just always love the idea, though, of that guy that something so horrific happened to, that his rest of his days were just trying to maintain, and even light itself was too much of an infringement upon his best soul. Yeah.
I'd rather just stay in the dark.
Yeah. You know, he's just done it. And he's just like, fucking Mexican women, huh? What? Mexican women. Just something happened. Something he saw or did or was.
And
a
he's
part
he's
of.
Just in an undershirt.
Yeah, so. Yeah, yeah.
But then the best is that you have to share like Thanksgiving dinner with that person. Like,
yeah, yeah. They'll come upstairs for that moment. All right, Dave. We're gonna send you on your way to do your book tour, my friend.
Thank you so much for having me. Always, and you guys got to. We can talk about this later, but you guys got to come on my radio show if I can drag you to Jersey City.
Yeah,
see,
that'd
that's
be great.
The problem. You're on the wrong side of the river.
I know. It's so you can see it.
Yeah.
From the banks of the Hudson, but yeah, it's a world away.
Going to Brooklyn seems like it makes sense, but going to Jersey City, it seems insane.
And even to ask feels aggressive. Yeah. I totally understand it. Yeah.
Well, I want to come over and do the show with you and Rufus and the Roaches and just
okay, yeah, we'll do that. We'll put
together. Nice for us.
We'll put together a perfect evening for you.
All right, that's it for us. We're going to give away a signed copy of this book too by Dave Phil, and we all enjoyed it here. You're
thank
really,
you
really
so
terrific.
Congrats. I'm honored.
Writer, and we'll see you the next time coming through.
Thanks.
Ladies and gentlemen, the evening is over. We hope you all enjoyed yourselves, and we'll see you all again in 1974. Good evening!